Without links, the World Wide Web would be a pretty boring place. Instead of being able to click to jump from page to page, you'd have to type in each unique address every time you wanted to view another page. It's no exaggeration to say that without the ability to create links, there would be no internet. So knowing how to create links in Dreamweaver is pretty important. It's also, you'll be glad to know, pretty easy. Before we get into how to create a link in Dreamweaver, let's take a moment to learn the basics of links and a few of the different types you can create. Links are nothing more than an address that points the browser to another location. The A, or anchor tag, is used to create links, and the href attribute is used by the browser to resolve the link's destination. Different types of links use different means to resolve link paths. Understanding the differences between these types will assist you in deciding which type of link to use in certain situations. There are three main types of links: absolute, document relative, and site route relative. Absolute links contain the entire path to the desired page, including the HTTP protocol. They are primarily used to resolve links outside of the current site, although in complex sites, or sites where pages are generated automatically, it's not uncommon to see them used to navigate internally in the site. This practice is discouraged as a general rule, since it takes absolute links longer to resolve. For links outside of your site, however, absolute links are required. Document relative and site route relative links are very similar. They offer you a way to resolve links within your own internal site. Document relative links are by far the most popular. Put simply, they are resolved by specifying the path from the current page to the desired page using the site file and folder structure. Forward slashes are used to denote going into a folder, while dot dot forward slash is used to signify going up and out of a directory. For example, if you were in a subdirectory and needed to access the index page in the root folder, the document relative link would be dot dot forward slash index.htm. If you were on the index page and needed to navigate to the photos.htm page in the lifestyles directory, the link would be resolved as lifestyles forward slash photos.htm. When two files are in the same folder, you can merely resolve the link by using the name and the extension of the file. Site route relative links are very similar to document relative links, with just one major difference. Instead of resolving the link using a relative path from the file's current location, you resolve the link by going back to the root directory and working your way down. The root directory is identified by using a forward slash at the beginning of the link and then working down the directory structure. Therefore, linking to the index.htm file would be resolved as forward slash index.htm, no matter where the link was created in your site. Site route relative links aren't as widely used, but they are great for creating links on pages that move around within your site a lot, or on pages that you aren't quite sure where their final destination is going to be. As we continue on in this chapter, we will explore creating external and internal links in our pages, as well as alternate link types like email and named anchor links. In many of the techniques used to create links in Dreamweaver, the link is resolved for you automatically without asking which type of link that you want. Well, this can sometimes lead to sites using one type of link when, in fact, the author actually requires the other. Well, this is a preference you can set in Dreamweaver, but it's not located where you might think. Most people that are new to Dreamweaver keep searching, in vain I might add, in Dreamweaver's preference dialog box for this setting. It is, in fact, chosen when you initially define your site and is editable at any time by simply editing your site. So here we are in Dreamweaver. We are on our Explorer California site. And I'm just going to go back to my site definition. One of the easiest ways to do this is go over to your Files panel and simply double-click the name Explorer California or whatever your current site may be. Doing that will bring the site setup dialog box back. And what I'm looking for is right here in the advanced settings. The local info in your advanced settings has this little radio button right here that says, do you want links resolved relative to the document itself or to the site route? Now, the default is document relative, so that if that is what you need for your site, you really should never have to change that. But if for whatever reason you need to start creating site route relative links, maybe you're working on a PHP-based site or maybe you're working on a site where files are going to move around a lot, you might want to switch that. But for most of the sites that you work on, you're probably just going to leave it as document relative, but it's very helpful to know where that's found because it is not found within the preferences. I'm going to go ahead and choose save for that so that we make sure that our links are going to be resolved as document relative links, and there we go. So choosing to have Dreamweaver resolve links as document or site root relative, it's pretty simple. You just have to remember it is in the site definition dialog box, not the preferences. Now, it is worth noting, as you will see, that many of the link creation techniques allow you to specify using either document or site root relative. So you don't have to keep editing this setting every time you want to change it. You simply might have to use a technique that you don't normally use when changing link types. By far, one of the easiest things to do in Dreamweaver is to create links. Well, that's a good thing, too, because you're going to be creating them so often. I can think of at least 6 ways to create links in Dreamweaver right off the top of my head, and I'm sure I'm probably missing a few. Honestly, though, no matter how many different techniques there are, you'll probably, like most designers, just use a few favorite core techniques when creating links on the page. In this movie, we're going to explore a few of those core techniques and talk about their pros and cons. So here I have the resources.htm file open from the 0903 folder. And there are a lot of things on the page here that need to link to other pages throughout our site. So this is a perfect page for us to be experimenting with. All right, so one of the first things I want to do is insert a link by using either the menu or my common objects. Now, for this link, it's actually better if you don't already have the text on the page. For the majority of the links that you're going to be working with, those techniques work great if the text is already on the page, but for this one, not so much. So if you read the first paragraph, you're going to see one sentence that looks a little odd. For example, this bit of text right here, and some that can help you. Seems like something's missing there, right? So I'm going to place my cursor right after the word some and hit space, and that is where we're going to be inserting our link. So what we want to do is we want to go up to our insert menu, and notice that when you go up to insert, one of the objects that you can insert on the page is a hyperlink. So you'll often hear links referred to as hyperlink, and that would insert a link on the page. Now that's going to give us a dialog box that has a few options that some of the other techniques that I'm about to show you don't have. So sometimes this is actually the preferred way of doing this. Now, the exact same type of link can be inserted on the page by using the insert panel. So let's go over to our common objects, and to show you how common they are, it's the very first object in common objects. So right there, that little link icon, you want to hover over that and just click it one time. So it doesn't matter whether you go from the menu or you go here, you're going to get a dialog box that comes up that, again, is going to give you some options that some of the other links don't give you. So the first thing it wants to know is, well, what text would you like for this link? We're going to type in additional resources. The next thing it wants to know is the link itself, and this is going to be what page do you want to go to. You can type it in yourself if you happen to know the exact path to that, or you can browse. I'm going to go ahead and browse here. And by browsing, if I'm working on a dynamic site, I can browse to a data source as well. So if you have a link being generated by a database, you can use this particular technique to get that as well. Well, I am going to go down into the 0903 folder. I'm going to find my resources folder, open that up, and inside that, I'm going to highlight this links.htm. That's the file that I want. I'm going to go ahead and click OK. And now we can see that that is resolving right there inside my link dialog box. Now the next thing that this is asking me is target. If you grab the pull down menu, you can see that there are a few sort of reserved keywords for this: blank, new, parent, self, and top. Now for the most part, those are referring to frames, and very few sites are using frames these days. However, you are going to occasionally want to use underscore blank. As we'll see later on when we're doing some of our absolute links, underscore blank will open up your link in either a new page or a new tab, depending upon the browser that you're using. Since we're linking internally to our site, we don't really want to do that, so I'm going to leave that blank. Here's my favorite part of this particular technique. Notice that we get to title our link right off the bat. So what is a link title? Well, think back to the chapter where we were working on images. When you place an image on the page, you need to give it alt text. That is alternate text that allows browsers and other user agents to sort of describe the image. Well, that's what titles do for us in links. When a link has a title, browser agents, screen readers, things like that, can give some feedback about what the link is. So this actually becomes sort of descriptive text. So for this title, for example, I could type in links to additional resources. And what's really nice about this is when somebody hovers over this link, a little tooltip that says exactly that will come up. We also have some accessibility options here. We could give an access key and a tab index to that. Not all pages require that amount of accessibility, and that's really a personal decision based off of the site you're working on. For the site we're doing, we don't really need to do those, so I'm just going to go ahead and click OK. Now notice what this method did for me. It went ahead and placed the text on the page, resolved the link for me, added a title to it, and it did that all at once. So that's actually a really efficient way of putting a link on the page. You'll hear some people say, well, I don't like going up to the menu, I don't like going up to the insert panel, but frankly, that method is going to give you some options that some of the other methods that we're about to do don't give you. So I really like that. All right, the next thing I want to do is towards the top of this paragraph, you're going to see here you'll find frequently asked questions or FAQs for each of our tour packages. That's going to link out to a page, so go ahead and highlight the FAQ portion of that. Now, down in your Properties Inspector, you're going to find a little area right down here for any link that you want to make. Now, you want to make sure you're looking at the HTML properties and not the CSS properties, so make sure you're on the HTML tab. Out beside that link dialog box, there are two symbols. One looks like a little target, and if you hover over it, it says point to file. The other one is a folder, and it allows you to browse for a file, and that's the one we're going to do here. So I'm going to click Browse for File, and that is going to jump me right in the resources directory, so I didn't even have to browse because that's where we went last time. But if you need to, just browse to the 0903 resources folder, and you want to highlight the faq.htm file. Once again, here you get a chance to resolve this document relative to either the document or the site root. So if you ever need to change it, based off of what is already defined in your site definition, this is one of the methods that will allow you to do that. I'm going to go ahead and click OK, and there it went ahead and resolved my link for me. Notice that it did not do a title for me. It did not prompt me for that. So if I wanted to title this, like just say frequently asked questions, I have to do that manually. So it's OK. It's another step that I can do, but if you forget that step and you meant to have a title there, that method doesn't prompt you for that. Okay, so the next thing we want to do is use the point to file icon. And it's one of my favorites. So I'm going to go right down here at the bottom of the paragraph and highlight the word contact. When you're looking to create a quick and easy link, there is nothing better than the point to file icon. So with the text contact highlighted, I'm going to go down to my properties inspector, once again making sure I'm on HTML properties, and I'm going to click and hold the mouse down on that point to file target. Now, once your mouse is held down, all you have to do is drag over to your files panel. So for this technique, you want to make sure that your files panel is visible. I'm just going to mouse over with the mouse held down, and I'm going to go right here to contact. Now, what happens if it's in a subdirectory and you forgot to open up the subdirectory? Well, that's not really a problem. If you hover over a subdirectory, that subdirectory will automatically open and give you access to anything inside of it. So this operation allows you to get whatever you'd like. I'm going to go right here to contact, hover over it, let go, and Dreamweaver finishes the link for me. Right there, contact.htm. Once again, there is no title, so if you want a title, you got to remember to do that manually. The last method I'm going to show you guys requires a little bit more manual labor. I'm going to go right here to the word privacy, just above terms, and we want to link to our privacy page. Now, our privacy page will be in our resources directory. We don't have one there right now just because we haven't created it. Just because you don't have a page over in your files panel doesn't mean that you can't create a link to it, especially if it's a page that you know you're going to be creating later on. The only problem with that is you can't browse to it because it's not already there. You can't use the point to file icon because it's not already there. So what you need to do is resolve that link manually. So knowing that the page that we're in right now, resources, is in the root directory, and knowing that privacy is eventually going to be in the resources subdirectory, then it's pretty easy for me to know how to resolve this link, even if the page doesn't exist. I'm going to place my cursor right there in the link dialog box. I'm going to type in resources/privacy.htm. The link is created, and even though that page doesn't exist just yet, it will eventually link to that page when we build it. So you can create links manually if you want to. You just have to remember to type them in. Spelling counts. and you are in charge of resolving that link. So you got to make sure that you know the path from where you are right now to where that page is going to be, and then you can go ahead and type that link in. Now, there is one more way to quickly create links that I want to show you before we finish this exercise. Let's scroll all the way down towards the bottom of the page, and we want to go right down to this section, Trip Planning. Here we can see that we're referencing the Frequently Asked Questions page again. Well, we've already made a link for that. If you've already made a link once in this page, you don't have to keep doing it. I'm going to highlight the text FAQ there. I'm going to go down to my Properties Inspector, and right where the link dialog box is, you can see that's actually a drop-down menu. So I'm going to go ahead and click that drop-down menu, and here are all the links that you've been working on in your site. So each and every page, every time you create a link, it's going to store it. And then every time you need a new link, if you've already created it, you can just grab that pull-down menu. So at this point, the only problem we're having is figuring out exactly where that is. And in this case, it's right here, resources/FAQ.htm. All I have to do is click there, and it's going to resolve that link for me. Now, we won't remember any of the other settings that you've done. So if you've already created a title for it, well, you're going to need to create that title again here, because it's not going to retain that. It's just going to retain the path to the image itself. So there you go. I think it's pretty easy to see why there are so many different ways to create links in Dreamweaver. Some are designed to allow fast and accurate link creation when simple links are required. Now, other methods are designed to accept more input based on the current needs of that particular link. You will find yourself using multiple techniques based on your link requirements and, frankly, your personal preferences. Be sure to practice creating links with each of these techniques so that you'll know which method to use based on the current situation. The methods you use to create absolute links are rather limited. Since you can't really browse to your hard drive for external websites, you're going to have to know the exact link. That can be tough at times, especially for longer generated links, so copying and pasting the link can be a real lifesaver. Let's check out building some absolute links. So here I have the resource.htm opened up, and I just have a couple of absolute links that I want to create for our site. I'm going to scroll all the way down towards the bottom section, and right here under the tour checklist section, we have the sentence, "For more information on traveling to California, go to visitcalifornia.com. So I'm going to go ahead and highlight visitcalifornia.com and click inside the link dialog box. There, I'm just going to type in http://www.visitcalifornia.com. Now I hit return. Notice that I had to type in the protocol as well. So not just www. Absolute links have to be the entire protocol, the HTTP or HTTPS or whatever the protocol is going to be. You have to place that on the front end of it. Now, I'm also going to go ahead and target this to a blank window. Now, this will either create a brand new window or a new tab based upon the browser that your users are using. The benefit of that is if you're going to send somebody away from your site, navigate them to another location online, you often want to make sure that your site stays up. That way, if they're browsing around for a while, they don't have to hit the back button 15 times to get back to your page, and if they close the tab, they're right back into your page. You should be a little careful about that, though, because you don't want to cause somebody to have 15 open tabs just by clicking around your site. So my advice to you there is just use it judiciously. So I'm going to go ahead and save this file. And there's another file that needs our attention. I'm going to go over to my Files panel. So I'm going to go in my Tours folder, and I want to open up the Tour Detail BigSur.htm. If I scroll down a little bit, I can see that at the very bottom I have this little paragraph where I can view hiking trail information or a map of Big Sur. Well, we want to send our users to Google Maps and give them a map of Big Sur. That's going to be a really long link, and frankly, I have no idea what it would be. So we're going to go out to Google Maps, find the map of Big Sur, and copy and paste its link into our own page here. So I'm going to switch out to my browser and go to Google Maps. And once I'm on Google Maps, I'm just going to type in Big Sur, California. Sure enough, it lands me right there on Big Sur. And now somebody has an idea of where this is. They can go in, find points of interest, all sorts of things. So I want to go ahead and send them to this page, but if you've noticed, the URL still just says maps.google.com. And that's not going to help me. If I copy and paste that link, they're still going to have to type in Big Sur, and that's not really helping. So what I'm going to do is go right over here, and you can see there's a little link right here for the link to that particular page. So I'm going to click on that, and it gives me two ways to embed that into my website. One would be just the link itself, and the other one would create an iframe which would embed the map on your page. Now, you're certainly free to do that, but what we're studying here is how to create absolute links, so that's not the solution that's going to work for us. So what I want to do is find this top section, and I just want to copy that. So I'm going to highlight that really long query string and copy that, and then go back into Dreamweaver. Once I'm back into Dreamweaver, I'm going to highlight the text, view a map of Big Sur, click inside the link dialog box, and paste. Now, be sure to hit return, and you'll notice that you have a long string of characters right in there. Once again, I'm going to target that to a blank page and do a save all. Make sure that you test this. So I'm just going to go ahead and preview this in my browser. I'm going to come down here to view a map of Big Sur and click on that. And I want to make sure that it goes right back to that Big Sur map I've had before. The reason for that is occasionally when you copy and paste into Dreamweaver's link dialog box, the link might become truncated. If it does, let me show you how to deal with that. We'll go back into Dreamweaver, and all you have to do is highlight your link, go into split screen view, and find the link itself. So here's the link tag that we're working with right now. Notice that the href attribute is the one that contains that really long query string to Google Maps. So if you just go into code view, if you highlight this and paste your link there, it's guaranteed to work. Sometime in the properties inspector, it truncates it a little bit, so you need to be aware of that particular behavior in Dreamweaver. It will sometimes get you in trouble, so make sure you test that thoroughly. So absolute links, they're just as easy to create as any other link in Dreamweaver. You just have to remember the protocol on the front of it. Leaving it off can create a broken link and frustrate your users. Now remember that using underscore blank for target allows people to browse in a new tab or a new window without leaving your site. And that can be both a good and a bad thing, so you need to think very carefully about usability before committing any link to a new window. While linking to other pages is usually the norm, there are times when you need to link to places within the same page. Usability is an important consideration when designing websites, and although people will usually tolerate scrolling a little bit for your information, if they have to scroll a lot, you're usually going to end up with some unhappy visitors. Named anchors allow us to link to places within the same page, allowing users to just jump further down the page, for example. Named anchors are aptly named because instead of the normal href attribute that links use to resolve the new location, named anchors are merely A or anchor tags that have a name and an ID attribute. Other links can reference this name to navigate to the location of the named anchor on the page. Since named anchors typically do not contain any text, and since they have no href attribute, they are totally invisible to the user. They are normally only used as points for the user to navigate to. So here we have our frequently asked questions, or FAQ.htm file open, and if we scroll down a little bit, it becomes apparent why named anchors are going to be such a nice addition to this page. So we have frequently asked questions for each of the tour packages. And we have about 5 or 6 questions for each tour package. So by the time you get to the last tour, you have done a lot of scrolling down towards the bottom of the page. So we're going to try to make life a little bit easier by allowing people to jump a little bit further down. Now, if you're paying attention to the page, you've also noticed that we already have links down here to allow a person to return to the top of the page. That is a really good point of usability. If you're going to allow somebody to jump further down the page to your content, you should also give them easy access back up to where they were before. Just because they don't have to scroll down doesn't mean that they're going to want to scroll back up. Okay, so creating named anchors and using them is pretty much a two-step process. The first step is to create the anchors themselves. And then the second step is then to then create a link to those anchors. So that's what we're going to do first. We're going to go ahead and create the named anchors themselves. All right. So I want to scroll towards the top of the page, but what I want to do is place my cursor right here in front of the large headline FAQ. This is where I want people to be able to jump back to if they've been reading my frequently asked questions. Why? Because just below this is the navigation to be able to jump down the page. That way they can read a little bit, jump right back up to the navigation, and jump back down again. So it's kind of a nice little system. So inserting a named anchor on the page is really, really simple. And the easiest way to do that is through the insert panel. So if we look at the insert panel and we find our common objects, you'll find this very, very nice little anchor symbol that is our named anchor. And you just want to click on that to insert a named anchor on the page. Now, when we name our anchors, we have to use standard naming conventions. So don't use any spaces, try to avoid punctuation, that sort of thing. As a matter of fact, I try to keep them to one word. If I do have to use two words, I usually use camel case naming, but underscores are also okay. I'm just going to name this one top because that's exactly what this link is. It's the top link on the page. Keeping them short makes them easy to remember and a lot easier to link to as well. I'm going to go ahead and click OK, and in comes my named anchor. Now, Dreamweaver shows us something pretty curious on the page now, and if I deselect it, I can see it a little bit more clearly. I see a little shield with that anchor symbol on it, and if I hover over that and click on it, I can see in the Properties Inspector, that's my named anchor, and its name is Top. I'm free to change that name anytime that I want, so once you place it on the page, if you forgot to name it something or if you meant to change the name, you can simply click on that and change it. Now, what is this? Well, that little yellow shield is something that we call invisible elements. And they can actually cause your layout to look like it's shifting around because Dreamweaver has to make a little bit of space for them. The fact of the matter is, though, no one will ever see them. You're only seeing them in here in Dreamweaver because otherwise they're in the code, but they're invisible. So in design view, we wouldn't be seeing them. As a matter of fact, if I go to split view, we can see right here is our new named anchor. A name equals top, ID equals top, and then the anchor tag closes out. So there's nothing inside of that. There's no text, and it just has a name and an ID. Also, if you don't like these shields, if they're kind of bug you and they get in your way, there's a couple of ways to get rid of them. Number one, you can go right up here to your document toolbar, go to visual aids, and you can turn off invisible elements right there. So that's a nice little toggle. Also, if you go to edit, and choose Preferences. On the Mac, you'd go to Dreamweaver and Preferences. You'll also find an Invisible Elements category. Here, you get to choose exactly which items show up as an invisible element. So if you didn't want name anchors to show up at all, but you still wanted some of your other invisible elements to show up, you could simply deselect the checkbox here. I'm going to hit Cancel because I don't want to make any changes. I kind of like having them out there, and as you're going to see in just a moment, they sort of extend our functionality a bit. Okay, so we have a little bit of work to do now. What we're going to need to do now is place named anchors at the top of each of those individual sections. So I'm going to place my cursor right in front of Backpack Cal, insert another named anchor, and I'm going to name this one Backpack. Again, we're just going to try to keep them short and just try to keep them single names. If I scroll down, I can see that the next section is California Calm. Now this time, I'm actually going to place my cursor on the line just above the headline California Calm. Later on, when we begin to test them, I'll talk about why I'm placing the named anchor here. I'm going to add another named anchor on the page, and this one is going to be Calm. I'm going to keep scrolling down, place another anchor on the page here. This anchor is going to be Hot Springs. I'm going to keep scrolling down. Above Cycle California, I'm going to place the anchor Cycle. So you can see you can pretty much get into a rhythm with this. From Desert to Sea, I'm going to insert another named anchor. I'm going to call this one Desert. Now, once again, it looks like everything is shifting down. Don't panic. That's not a big deal. The named anchor just needs a little bit of room visually, but since that's an invisible element, when you preview that in your browser, you won't see it. So there we've just created the named anchor Kids. We'll follow that up with Nature in the next section. Snowboard just underneath that. And then finally, for Taste of California, we'll just do Taste. So it's pretty easy to put in your named anchors. It's a very fast process. But one of the things you want to do is make sure that you have a naming convention already set up and that you're aware of what that naming convention is. It's just going to make creating the links themselves a little bit easier. Okay, so now that we've done that, we need to go ahead and create our links. So if I scroll back up, I can see that we have this navigation section up here, Backpack Cal, California Calm. So the users would click on that to jump down to the actual link themselves. Well, there are a couple of different ways to create these links, and they're very easy to do. I'm going to go ahead and highlight the text Backpack Cal. And using the point to file icon down here in the Properties Inspector, I can literally just point right there to the invisible element. As soon as I let go, notice that it resolves it as pound backpack. So that's one of the reasons to keep the invisible elements on the page. We can use the point to file icon to quickly point to those. Now, notice also how this link was resolved. This is really important. Do you notice the pound symbol in front of the word backpack? Well, pound identifies that as an ID. So to link to any named anchor on the page, all you have to do is pass its ID as the href of a link, and it'll jump right to that specific point. Now, we could certainly use the point to file icon again. I could highlight California Calm, for example, use the point to file icon, And if it's off the page, just place your appointment file icon towards the bottom of the page. It'll scroll automatically. If for whatever reason that doesn't happen, you can just place it right over the scroll bars at the bottom, and it'll scroll that way too. Then you can point to the invisible element that represents the link that you want and let go, and it resolves. Honestly, though, if you can remember what you've named them and they make sense to you, typing them in yourself is the fastest way to do this. So notice I can just highlight hot springs right here, type in pound hot springs. You have to remember the pound symbol, and that link resolves. I'm going to do the same thing all the way down. I'm going to do pound cycle, pound desert, pound kids. Also notice there's no space here. Pound nature, pound snowboard, and finally, pound taste. So yes, the point to file icon would have been fast, but I don't think it would have been that fast. Now, we're not quite done. We have one more thing to do before we can test our page. I know we've been working for a while, but let's go and take care of this really fast. We noticed that we have some links down here that say return to top. I'm going to go all the way down to the very bottom of the page so I can find the very bottom one of those. And highlighting that link tag, I'm going to type in pound top. Now, after you've already resolved one of these links once, remember, you don't have to do it again. You can simply click in the next one, grab that pull-down menu, and find pound top. So after that, you don't have to keep typing them in or using the point to file icon. You can simply click inside the link, grab the pull-down menu for the link itself, and find the named anchor that you are going towards. That is really quick, really easy. You just want to make sure you're going to do that for every single one of those guys. And if you're more comfortable typing that in, there's nothing wrong with that either. Okay, so that should do it for us. I'm going to go ahead and save this file. And now I want to preview this in my browser so that I can test their functionality. So here I am previewing this in Firefox. And if I click on Taste of California, notice that it takes me all the way down to the bottom of the page. Clicking on the return to top brings me right back up to my navigation, so I can simply go anywhere that I want and click back and forth simply by using the links that we've created. Now, I want to point something out to you. Do you notice how instead of coming right up to the headline, we're actually landing just a little bit above it? That's because that's where we place the named anchor. The page is going to navigate exactly to that named anchor. So if we would have placed our named anchor in front of the K here, it would look like that. Now, there's nothing wrong with that, but think about usability. If you were to jump here, the first thing you would do is scroll up a little bit to make sure you hadn't missed anything. So by going ahead and placing that in there automatically, it sort of tells people, yes, you are in the right place. So I always put my named anchors just a little bit above where I want to link on the page. Now, obviously, not every page you're working with is going to need named anchors. However, when your data does require a lot of scrolling, or if you want to give people quick access to a specific location, named anchors allow you to add a lot of functionality to your page. In our next movie, we're going to take named anchors one step further by linking to a named anchor on an external page. Linking to a point within the same file using named anchors is extremely helpful in negotiating large amounts of data or moving quickly to important information. It stands to reason, then, that one would also want the ability to jump to that specific information from other pages as well. Well, luckily for us, linking to named anchors on other pages is just as simple as using named anchors within a single page. So here I have open the FAQ.htm and the tour detail backpack.htm. Now, I've got both of those open, and the default view for multiple documents open in Dreamweaver is to open them in these tabs. And that's nice because you can tab back and forth between them. But for the technique I'm going to show you guys, it's really helpful for us to be able to see these at the same time. So I'm going to go up to Window and choose Tile Vertically. And what that's going to do is it's going to place them right beside each other, which is perfect. This is exactly what I want. Now, if you need a little bit more screen real estate, remember that you can take your panel dock and you can collapse those down to icons. And if you want, you can just go ahead and tile vertically again. It'll go ahead and fill that space. You don't have to try to do that manually. All right, so what I want to do now is I want to go over to my tour detail backpack.htm. I want to scroll down, and down towards the bottom of that, I have this little sentence right here, learn more about Backpack Cal tours. Well, on the tour information page, my frequently asked questions, I have a section that details Backpack Cal. And I want to jump, instead of the top of the page, just right to Backpack Cal itself. So what I'm going to do is over here in the tour detail page, highlight the text backpack cow. I'm going to go down to my properties inspector, and using the point to file icon, which is such a fast and efficient way to create links, I can point right to that named anchor right there. Now, when I do that, take a look at the links dialog box. It's going to go out of the tour directory into the resources directory, find the frequently asked questions page, and find that particular named anchor backpack. So really, it's just adding that ID to the back of that link. As soon as I let go, our link is resolved. I can do a save all. And if I want, you can just maximize those out again. And I'm just going to preview that in my browser to make sure that this is working properly. So now I'm going to scroll down, and there's our backpack cow link. And when I click on that, notice what happens. It jumps right to the resource page. And when it jumps to the resource page, it jumps right to the fact page, right down to the backpack cow section, which is exactly what we want. How easy was that? Whether you need to link to a specific location on the same page or jump to a location on an external page, using named anchors is a great way to increase the usability of your site. Email links allow users to click on a link and automatically generate an email to the specified address. Dreamweaver makes creating email links incredibly simple, and just like most options in Dreamweaver, there are multiple ways to do it. Before we delve into the specifics of creating email links in Dreamweaver, I want to talk to you for just a moment about the pros and cons of using the techniques I'm about to show you. The default method of creating email links in Dreamweaver is dead simple and makes giving your users the ability to contact you even easier. Dreamweaver will insert a link, including the text of your choice, surrounded by an anchor that links to the defined email. A simple click from the user, and they are composing an email to the address of your choice. Now, the downside to inserting email links this way is that spam bots find and catalog your email address even easier, and your spam filter will receive a workout from that day forward. Now, to combat this, several techniques have evolved, and frankly are continuing to evolve, that hide your email address from spam bots. The most effective techniques use either JavaScript or server-side code to process the email link without exposing it to the bots. While these techniques are outside the scope of this video, you can easily find full descriptions by doing a quick Google search. They are certainly worth researching if you plan on having email links on your page. So here we have the contact.htm file open. And if I scroll down just a little bit, right above our contact forms, we have a couple of lines of text here where we're giving the users the option of emailing us instead of filling out the forms. So we're going to do a really quick email link here. I'm going to find the sentence, "If you feel like sending a quick email, you can fire one off by clicking here." I'm going to go ahead and highlight the word here. Now, inserting an email link is indeed very, very simple. We're just going to go up to our insert panel, find the common objects, and the second option right there is an email link. So when I click this, a dialog box with two options are going to come up, text and email. Now, I've already typed the text on the page. When I highlighted it, that's why here already filled in. And the last email address that you've added to your page is going to show up there as well. Now, for most of you, that is probably going to be blank, and that is fine. So just go ahead and click inside the email area and type in support@explorecalifornia.org. There we go. And really, any email address you want to use, if you want to test this out on your own, you go right ahead. You can type in any email link there that you want, no problem. Go ahead and click OK, and Dreamweaver goes ahead and adds the link for us. Now, take a look at what it's added down here in our properties inspector. So the link is resolved by using mail to, all one word, colon, and then the email address. So if you ever want to resolve one of those manually, just highlight some text, click inside the link dialog box, and then all you have to do is type in mail to, colon, and then the email address. Very easy. Now, you can do some manual tweaking of email addresses as well. Let me show you what I'm talking about. The next sentence says, also, if you would like a catalog of our most popular tours, email us here. Well, what if we don't really have a separate email for that, but we just want people to send that, and perhaps we have some sort of filter set up that says, okay, if that email contains a request for a calendar, put it in this inbox so we know where to find it. Well, you can often do that by forcing a subject line. So rather than making somebody type in a subject line, when they click this link, their email will already have the subject line filled in. Let me show you what I mean. I'm going to highlight email us here, and then using the pull down menu for link, I'm going to go ahead and choose mail to support at explorecalifornia.org. That's just going to save me a good bit of typing, although if you feel like typing that in, be my guest, go right ahead. Just type in mail to, all one word, support@explorecalifornia.org, or whatever email address you're going to be using. Now, at the very end of this, right after the ORG, I'm going to type in a question mark. This is one of the reasons why we never use punctuation for the names of objects, because punctuation can sometimes mean something. And in this case, it's a separator between our email address and the subject line that we're about to type. Right after that, with no spaces, type in subject equals, and then whatever you want. In this case, I'm going to type in catalog request. Now here you can add spaces, capitalization, none of that matters, because this is just going to be a string that's passed into that. So question mark subject equals catalog request. I'm going to hit return. Now, if you'd like, go ahead and preview that in your browser. Click the link, and in your email client, you should notice the subject line already pre-filled in. That's going to make your users a little bit happier, because if they're requesting a catalog, they're not going to have to fill out the subject line all by themselves. It'll be there for them, so they won't have to wonder, hey, what should I put? And for you, that'll allow you to create rules within your email client that basically says, if you receive an email with a subject line, put it in the subdirectory so that I know exactly what they're asking me for. So that's pretty cool, right? Now, email links are a good way to help clients or users get in touch with you, but exposing your email link on the page is a risk that you need to consider before adding them using the default Dreamweaver method. Now, keep in mind that you can customize your email links as well for added functionality. Although we aren't going to do anything in this movie that we haven't already done in one form or another, stick with me, because in this movie, we're going to tie everything we've learned about styling links together to explore making CSS-based rollovers. The ability to create CSS-based rollovers is based off of the use of what we call pseudo-selectors. There are many pseudo-selectors, but the link, visited, hover, and active pseudo-selectors allow us to respond to user interaction for our links. In this movie, we will create a CSS-based rollover for our frequently asked questions links. By creating a separate visual state for the link and the hover, we can create a more compelling visual guide to the page's navigation. So I have the faq.htm file open, and if I scroll down, I can see that the links that are going to take us down the page don't look quite as good as they used to, but that's because we've ripped all the styling out of it, and we're going to style it again. All right, now I want to bring up another toolbar here for this exercise. So what I'd like you to do, go up to the document toolbar, right-click that or control-click that if you're on a Mac with a single button mouse, and choose Style Rendering. So our Style Rendering toolbar is going to come up. Now, I'm going to dock mine up in this area. And actually, I can really pretty much dock it anywhere I want, or I can float it around. I just want to place it in a place where it's not going to take up a lot of screen real estate. Now, if you're on a Mac, it is going to dock within the document toolbar, and you cannot move it around. So hopefully, its placement will be okay for you. Now, notice that the Style Rendering toolbar, right here on the end, has some pseudo class selectors. We have link, visited, hover, and active. So as we begin to style these, we can preview them here locally by simply previewing that particular state. The next thing that we're going to do is we're going to give ourselves a little bit more room here, because we're going to do a little bit more hand coding. Please don't panic. This is really simple stuff. And we're going to go through it step by step. So if you haven't done a lot of hand coding, don't worry about it. I promise you, the more you do it, the easier it will get for you. Okay, I'm going to go right over here to our panel dock, and I'm going to collapse that down to icons. It's going to give me a little bit more room. And then I'm going to go to a split screen view so that I can see the code on the one side and my objects on the other. So what I'm going to do is scroll down just a little bit more and find my first link, Backpack Cal, right there. Now, by using the code Navigator, you can hold down the Command Option key on the Mac and click on that, or on the PC, you can simply Alt-click them, and up comes your code Navigator. Yes, there are a lot of styles being applied here, but there are two in particular that we're interested in, the very two at the bottom. The first one is dealing with the link state. The second one is dealing with the hover state. So as we are writing these, we're going to talk about what these pseudo class selectors allow us to do. So I'm going to click on the second one right here, pound main content, pound main article, ul.faq nav li a:link. All right, so just click on that. That will jump in our CSS, so our code should just jump right there. And I want to break down these selectors because, taken as they are right now, they can be a little confusing. So let's talk about those. So essentially it's saying, hey, look in the main content region, find the main article inside that, and find an unordered list with the class of FAQ nav, which is exactly what this is inside of. Then find an individual list item. Inside that, locate a link. So all that just to drill down to one specific link. So it's a very specific selector. But this is what I want you to focus on right here. A:link. Now, just underneath that, we have the exact same thing repeated, but A:visited. Okay, so what does link and visited actually mean? Link means that it is an anchor tag with an active href attribute. So an href attribute that points somewhere. So this wouldn't apply to a named anchor, but it would apply to any link that is actually going somewhere else off the page. Now, visited is the visited state of a link. You know, often you'll click on a link and then you come back to the page and there's some type of an indicator that you've been there before. Maybe the link changes color, or perhaps there's an icon beside it to let you know that you visited the page before, but that's what that allows you to do. Now, the comma between these two means that these are being grouped. Now, why would we group those two? Well, in this case, we really don't want to actively show a difference in the linked and the visited state. We don't want the browser to continually update it if it's been visited because it kind of ruins the look and the feel of it. There are certain menus and lists that benefit from visited links, but this is not one of them. So if you want to ensure that the browser doesn't change your styling or change the way a link looks, you can group those two selectors together and you know that the normal state of the link and the visited state of the link will look exactly the same. So those are what those two pseudo selectors are doing for us. Okay, I'm going to click right inside the empty declaration and we're going to start styling our links. So the first thing I'm going to do is give them a background color. So I'm just going to type in background and then a colon. And then the color that we're going to type in is #CCC and then a semicolon. So that's a light gray. So the word background, then a colon, and then #CCC and a semicolon. Now remember from our earlier lesson on CSS, you have the property on this side, you have the value of the property on this side, and they are separated by a colon. The semicolon tells it to quit reading this line and go to the next one. Speaking of that, let's go to the next line. On the next line, we're also going to give these a border. So I'm going to type in border. And we can use a little shorthand notation here. We're going to do 1 pixel, space, and then solid, and then space, and then #999, and then a semicolon. Now, in this instance, I was taking advantage of code hinting. So if you begin typing, often Dreamweaver will give you a list, and you can just go ahead and choose from that list, hit return, and it will finish it for you. That often prevents you from having to really work with a lot of the syntax. You don't have to worry about typing in the colon, that sort of thing. So now you can actually see in the design view, it's starting to update every single time we do one of these, which is really kind of nice. Now, after that, we're going to do a little bit of padding. So I'm going to type in a P. It jumps down to padding. Notice that. And I can hit return or enter, and it'll go ahead and finish typing that for me. And it will type the colon, which is pretty cool. For padding, I'm going to do 5 pixels and then a space, then 0, and then a space, 5 pixels, another space, and then 10 pixels. And then a semicolon. So the first value is going to be the top padding. So that's going to be the space between the text and the top of the element. The second one is right padding. We don't really need any right padding because most of our text is not going to make it all the way over. The third value there, I should say, is the bottom padding. And then the fourth one is the left. So we're pushing the text 10 pixels away from the edge of our element. We're giving it 5 pixels of space top to bottom. And then we're really not worrying about the right side at all because we don't need to worry about that. The text won't make it that far over. So that should give us some extra space inside that so that the background color doesn't do what it does right now, which is butt right up against the edge of that. All right. So I'm going to hit return and go down to the next line. And on the next line, I'm going to do font size. So font-size. And here we're going to do 0.85 em. So I'm going to make the font size a little bit smaller, 0.85 em, so that it fits within these boxes nicely. So just make that a little bit smaller there. By the way, I know you've noticed that when you type in a unit of measurement, like pixels or ems, you use that small abbreviation. There's no space between the value and the unit of measurement. If you leave a space there, that could cause a problem. Next, we're going to go down to the next line, and we're going to type in a color. The color for this one is going to be #1937.42. 1937.42. So I'm going to hit return, and I'm going to type in width. And for some reason, be very careful about typing in WID because I always end up with widows, but I want width. So let's do width, and we're going to do 170 pixels. On the very next line, we're going to do display, and we're going to do block. Okay, now what am I doing that for? Well, these two values, width and display, are going to make sure that the link extends for that entire box. That's what block is going to do for us. And forcing a width in there forces browsers like Internet Explorer to make the entire box clickable and not just the text area. Now, if I click inside the design view, it should update that. There we go. Notice that we get that sort of teal color. We get the gray all the way around that, and our padding is giving us a little bit of distance between the text itself and the box. Perfect. So go ahead and do a save all. And now the normal state of the link is going to look like this, and the active state of the link is going to look like this. But to create a true CSS-based rollover, we now have to work on the hover state. Well, that's what the selector just below this one is going to do for us. So I'm going to scroll down, and just like we did last time, I want to go over this selector. Now, the first part of it is exactly the same, so that whole long path to the element remains the same. However, here, we're doing a hover and a active. Let's talk about those two. Hover is the state of the link when somebody is actively hovering over it. So when somebody rolls over your link, that is considered to be a hover. Active means somebody is actively clicking on the link, or if somebody clicks to a link and then hits the back button right away, focus on that link might still be there. So you might see the active version of that. You know, sometimes you see a little border around the link or a little dotted border. That means the link still has focus. So that would be the hover and the active state. Once again, we're grouping those together because we want those to look the same. We don't want any other styling to interrupt our link. Okay, now this one doesn't require as much work as our last selector because here we're just going to change a couple of values. We're going to change some color, foreground and background color, and then we're also going to change the border as well. So the first thing I'm going to do here is type in color. So just type into your selector there, type in color, colon, pound, FFF. That's white, so we're going to change the text to white. Hit return to go down the next line, and here type in background, and the color we're going to use here is pound CB7D20. So CB7D20, and then a semicolon. That's sort of an orange color. And then go down to the very next line and type in border, 1 pixel, space, solid, space, pound 666. So it's going to be a little bit of a darker color. So as you hover over it, the border will get a little bit darker as well, although it's going to stay the same size. Now, I'm going to scroll back up just a little bit so you guys can see my code. And if you need to, just go ahead and pause the video and look at that code a little bit more closely. Hand coding your CSS is not hard. Dreamweaver gives us a lot of code hinting, and if you kind of know what you're doing and know the properties, you can go through it pretty quickly. However, if you're brand new to CSS, obviously these properties aren't going to be familiar to you, the values aren't going to be familiar to you. And if you're not absolutely precise with this code, meaning one character is off, you forget a space, you forget a colon, then it could cause your entire CSS not to work or sections of it not to work, certainly this not to work. So you want to take just a second, maybe pause the video, go over each line of code, make sure everything is exactly as you see it here, and you should be in good shape. While you're doing that, I'm going to go ahead and do a save all right? And now I'm going to go preview these. Now, I can certainly preview them in my browser, and I'm going to do that in just a moment. But I want to use this cool new feature in the style rendering toolbar. I really like this because now I can come over and say, okay, that's what my normal links look like. What about my hover? So I'm going to click on hover, and you might notice a slight change in your layout. It's okay. Dreamweaver sometimes has trouble rendering certain issues. And as I scroll down, I can see now that my links have orange background color. They have a sort of a darker border around them. And things don't look the way maybe we wanted it to. So when you first do this, you might panic a little bit, but don't. What Dreamweaver is doing here is only showing you the hover attributes. CSS is cumulative. So the padding, the lack of decoration on the text, the lack of the underline there, the width of those things, those are not being shown because they're not part of the actual hover selector, but they're still there. So really you're going to use this style rendering hover preview to just see specific information. Did I get the orange background color right? Is the border color right? That sort of thing. Don't trust this as an accurate preview. For that, we're going to go ahead and preview this in the browser, or we could use the live view feature here as well. So I'm going to click back on links, make sure I've done a save all, and then preview that in my browser. As soon as I do that, I can hover over my links, and sure enough, I get a nice CSS-based rollover. So our background color is changing, the foreground color is changing, the border is changing a little bit, so we're doing all of that through the link, visited, hover, and active pseudo selectors. Obviously, this is a little bit of a complex selector because of how specific it is, but this works for any link that you're currently working on. You can also swap out background images as well, and you may have remembered that we've done that earlier. Now, whether you're creating a menu, changing the default styles of your link site-wide, or just creating a group of rollovers like we have here, the proper use of the link, visited, hover, and active pseudo selectors allow us to create dynamic rollovers without using any JavaScript. Now, one thing that you need to keep in mind If you're going to use these pseudo-selectors, you have to use them in the correct order. If you place the hover, for example, above the visited, then after you visited a link, you have no more hover. The visited overwrites it. So most people use the device love-hate, LVHA, as a way of reminding them the proper order: link, visited, hover, and active. Grouping the pseudo-selectors, as we've done here, is another way to prevent those types of problems. Now, for additional information on what can be done with links in these pseudo-selectors, you might want to watch the Chapter 7 movie on positioning background images, where we create something very similar to this by shifting the position of background images in an element. One of the biggest challenges that most designers have when learning CSS-based layouts is structuring their content correctly. Some are tied to older layout methods like table-based layouts, while others are just brand new to web design and don't fully understand the strategies behind controlling page elements through CSS. Regardless of whether you fit into one of those categories or not, the foundation for learning proper CSS layout is based in learning to structure your page correctly. By identifying unique areas of content, you are not only helping user agents properly parse your content, you're also giving yourself the basic page structure needed to control your layout. To give your page this structure, you will use the div tag. The div tag is a generic block-level tag that is used to divide your content into specific regions. By using CSS, you can style and position these regions, thereby creating your layout. Now, although every page is different, some basic standards have evolved that make laying out your pages a little more efficient. First, most pages have a wrapper div tag that wraps all other content on the page. This container div allows you to define a width for your page content, center content on the page, and give all other content a reference point by which to position itself by. Inside the wrapper div, you will position other divs that represent your content regions in the order that you wish the content to be accessed. You should never lose sight of the fact that many users may and will encounter your page content unstyled. In that event, you want to make sure they experience your page in the order that you intended. In the layout we'll be creating, for example, all wrapper will contain a header, navigation, a content region, a sidebar, and a footer. Each of these distinct regions will be styled and positioned based on our design and based on the content contained within. Although this sounds counterintuitive, I've found that my page structure has become increasingly simpler over the years. When I first started doing CSS-based layouts, my pages were unnecessarily complex. That was because I didn't really understand the goal behind separating structure and presentation, and because I didn't understand how to build efficient CSS layouts. I positioned nearly every single element on the page and needed almost twice as many elements due to this. So my advice for creating a CSS-based layout is this: keep the page structure simple. Let the structure exist to express meaning, not to fit a predefined design. And, as we'll discuss later in this chapter, let the normal document flow of HTML do the bulk of your layout for you. Normal document flow states that the first block-level element will be displayed on top of the next block-level element. You'd be surprised at how well that handles most of the layout needs you'll have. Any discussion on CSS-based layouts should start with the box model. Understanding the box model is crucial to controlling page layout. Every element in your document is contained within a box, even the inline-level elements. Browsers use an element's box properties to determine how much space it takes up on your page. Controlling these values gives us control over much of our layout. The box model is made up of five basic properties: an element's width, height, padding, border, and margins. Backgrounds do take advantage of the box model. They display inside an element all the way to the element's borders, but they're not technically part of the box model itself. Not understanding the box model clearly can have serious consequences to your layout. Without understanding the box model, you might think that an element's total width and height are determined by the width and height property. In fact, they're determined by a combination of the width, height, padding, and borders. Starting inside an element and working our way out, we start with an element's width and height properties. Next is padding. The padding keeps the element's contents away from the edge of the element itself. Then we have borders. Now, borders are optional, and you can have different styles of borders, such as solid or dashed or dotted, but borders also have a width and a color. So the width of a border, an element's padding, and the width and height of that element all calculate together to form the total width and height of the element. Now, what about margins? Where do they come in? Well, margins don't technically calculate to the width and height of an element. However, they do help define the relationship between elements, so they're used to determine the amount of space between one element and another. Now, the best way to truly understand the box model is to go ahead and control those properties for yourself. So let's dive in and set some values. So here I have the boxmodel.htm file open, and you can find this in the 10.02 folder. Now, before we start modifying some properties, I want to take a moment to discuss the structure of the page. Currently, we have a paragraph, which is within a div tag with an ID of container, and that's also found within the body tag. We have some very basic CSS going on our page right now, so let's take a moment and see what we have. So if I go over to the CSS styles panel, I can see that I have a rule right here targeting the paragraph inside the container, and all I've got is a background color, and it's that light tan background color that we're seeing here. Now, the container div tag itself also has a background color, and it's sort of a darker teal blue color, but we can't see that right now. The reason that we can't see it is because if you have a block level element, it's going to expand to fill its entire container element. So right now, our inner paragraph, since there's no padding or borders or anything holding it away from the edge of the div tag, is going all the way to the edge of the div tag. Let's start setting some box model properties and see how it affects these two elements. The first thing I'm going to do is select the pound container P selector. I'm going to go ahead and add a width and a height to it. So I'm going to add a property. I'm going to add width. And I'm going to give it a width of 300 pixels. Then I'm going to add another property. I'm going to add height and give it a height of 300 pixels as well. Now, while I'm typing this in, you can see that I'm just sort of typing these values. But when you define any property, anytime you say add property, let me hit enter so I get my height. But anytime you hit add property, you get a pull down menu. So if you don't feel like typing these properties in that we're talking about, you can add them that way as well. Okay, so we have a height of 300 pixels and we have a width of 300 pixels. Now, that has created a dramatic change in our paragraph and our container. Within our paragraph now, we see the 300 by 300 size of it. And we now begin to see some of the background color of the containing div tag. So why don't we see all of it? Well, your paragraph is lining up to the top left-hand corner of the div tag itself. That's pretty standard in HTML. Child elements will align top left-hand corner to their parent elements unless you do something to move them away from that position. So our paragraph is just butting right up against the top left edge. However, we've defined a width for our paragraph, but we haven't defined a width for our containing div tag. And because of that, the containing div tag is now expanding to fill its parent container, which in this case is the body tag. So whereas we've defined a width and a height for the paragraph tag, we haven't defined one yet for the container. Its height is being determined by its contents, in this case the paragraph. Its width is being defined by the body tag. Now let's add some box properties to our containing element and see how it affects our layout. So I'm going to go up to the pound container ID selector. I'm going to add a property here. And I want to go ahead and define a width for it as well. So I'm going to go ahead and add a width, and I'm going to give it a width of 300 pixels. That's exactly the same width we gave the paragraph. When I hit return, you'll notice that our parent container disappears. Or does it? Well, we don't see the width anymore, but within Dreamweaver here, we are seeing something going on top and bottom. What's going on there? Well, not maybe what you think. I'll tell you what. Go up to the document toolbar and turn on live view. When we turn on live view, oh, that's what we expect. We expected to see nothing because now the parent container is exactly the same size as our paragraph. So how come design view shows us a little bit of space up top and a little bit of space on the bottom? What design view is doing is design view is taking into consideration the default margins for your paragraph. Every element in a browser has default margins. And with a paragraph, we get about 16 pixels worth of space above it, 16 pixels worth of space below it. So how come we wouldn't see that when a browser renders it? Well, that is a curious little property called vertical margin collapse. When a vertical margin touches another vertical margin, they collapse to the highest of the two values. So if you have a paragraph with 20 pixels worth of margin below it, followed by another paragraph with 10 pixels worth of margin above it, you wouldn't get 30 pixels between the two of them, you'd only get 20, the higher of the two values. The reason for that is we don't want all of our elements to be double-spaced. We want them to be single-spaced, and that's why vertical margins collapse. Now, it even gets more curious when you evolve a nested tag with a parent tag like we have here. When you have a nested tag, if its margin touches the edge of the parent container with nothing in the way, no other content, no other padding, no other margins, then you get this margin collapse. That is something that has caused problems in more than one layout. I promise you that. Let's add a little bit something more to our container and see if it deals with this vertical margin collapse. I'm going to go up to the containing element, and let's add a little bit of padding to this. We're going to go ahead and add 20 pixels worth of padding all the way around. Now when we switch over in live view, I see 20 pixels worth of space to the left and to the right of the paragraph. And at the top and bottom, wow, now I'm seeing more than 20 pixels. Okay, what's going on there? Well, remember what I said earlier. Vertical margins collapse when a nested element's margins go all the way up and touches the edge of its parent container. It can't do that anymore. Now we have 20 pixels of padding right here, which means the margin also touches that padding. Margins and padding would add together, and now we're getting probably about 36 to 40 pixels worth of space between the top of the paragraph and the top of its parent container. Layout can sometimes be a little tricky, so these are things that you have to understand when you're starting to use box model properties to control your elements. Okay, let's take this a little bit further. Let's examine how we can use our box model properties to achieve a very common technique in CSS-based layouts, and that is the centering of one element inside of another one. I'm going to make the container a tad bit wider. Let's see. I'm going to go to my container, and I'm going to go ahead and make this 600 pixels wide. So let's say we want to center that paragraph inside of its parent container. All we have to do that is to take advantage of margins. If I go back into my paragraph selector, I can add another property, and the property I'm going to add here is margin. And this time I'm going to use a little shorthand notation. Shorthand notation allows us to add just one margin value instead of having to add separate values for the top, bottom, right, and left. So what I'm going to do is 0, and then a space, and then I'm going to type in the word auto. Let's talk about what that's going to do. The 0, the first value, is going to represent the top and the bottom. So when you use margin and use two values like we're doing here, the first value applies to the top and the bottom of the element. The second value applies to the right and the left. So what we're doing is we're taking that default margin that's causing that little bit of extra space up top, and we're going to 0 that out. Now the next thing we're doing is auto margin for the left and right. Now what auto margin basically does is it says, okay, calculate the width of the parent, split it in two, put half of it on the right, half of it on the left. What's that going to do for us? Well, let me hit return. That's going to center the paragraph right in the middle of the containing element. Later on, we're going to use that technique to center our page layout on our page. Notice also what happened to the spacing above our paragraph. No longer are we seeing that extra spacing. We're just seeing those 20 pixels worth of padding that we put in. By zeroing out that top margin, we've eliminated that extra spacing that was causing that little awkward gap that we had up there. All right, let's add one more box model property. I'm going to go right down to our paragraph, and let's add a border. So I'm going to add a property to this, and I'm going to type in border. Once again, we'll do a little shorthand notation here. By hitting tab, that'll move me over to the next dialog box, and I'm going to type in 5 pixels. So we're going to do a fairly thick border here. Solid, pound FFF, so white. So 5 pixels, solid, and white, and hit return. So now we have a 5-pixel border all the way around our paragraph. We have auto margins right and left, and we're getting our space up top from the padding of the parent containing element. Now, I don't like the way that text is butting right up against the paragraph, so let's go ahead and fix that while we're at it. So I'm going to go ahead and add a property to our paragraph. We'll add some padding, and let's add 20 pixels worth of padding all the way around our inner paragraph as well. So now we get the layout that we're looking for, sort of. We have 20 pixels worth of padding on all the way around the interior of our paragraph. We have 5 pixels worth of a border, and then we have some auto margins going over here on the right and the left-hand side. So when we're factoring up the total width of our parent containing element, we have to take a lot into consideration here. First, we have to take in the width of the containing element itself. Currently, that width is 600 pixels wide. But we also have to take a look at the padding inside of it as well. We have 20 pixels worth of padding and 600 pixels worth of width. So 20 pixels on one side, and 20 pixels on the other side, that gives us a total width of 640 pixels. For the most part, your interior content won't disrupt that width unless it's going to equal more than that. If we were trying to calculate the size of our inner paragraph, we would see it's 300 pixels wide. We have padding of 20 pixels, which would be 20 on the left, 20 on the right, so 340 total. And then our 5 pixels worth of border would equal 350. So in this case, the interior paragraph really isn't affecting the outer div tag. But those are things that you have to keep your eye on when you're doing and planning your layout. Often you're going to find yourself subtracting certain width values or adding certain values to it just so you can achieve the proper layout. And I want to illustrate what that can do to your layout here for just a moment. Let's say I go back up to our containing element and I tell it instead of being 600 pixels to go ahead and be 300 pixels. What happens? Well, that's what happens. Notice that the inner paragraph no longer will fit. So even though the inner paragraph is told to be 300 pixels wide, it no longer fits because of the padding and the border that we have on it as well. So what happens is our elements overflow each other, and that's really not what we want. So if we're going to try to figure out how to have exactly the same amount of space all the way around this, let's say 20 pixels all the way around our outer paragraph, we got to factor out what the width of the paragraph is, including its padding and its borders, and add the proper amount of padding around our containing element. Let me show you what I mean. So our nested paragraph is 300 pixels wide. We have 40 pixels worth of padding when you add up both sides, so that's 340 pixels. And then finally, we have 5 pixels worth of borders, so that's another 10 pixels. So now we're up to 350 pixels. So we have 350 pixels from side to side, but we also want 20 pixels on either side of it. So if I go up to my containing element, I can say, all right, let's go ahead and be 350 pixels wide, and we have 20 pixels worth of padding on either side, and we get exactly what we were looking for. So now that we have a handle on our margins, borders, padding, height, and width, and how they can affect overall dimensions and relationships with other elements on the page, we can move on to talking about more layout-specific topics. Next up, we're going to be using the CSS float property for layout. Most CSS-based layouts are float-based layouts. That is, the majority of the elements in the layout are floated to achieve element positioning. Although floated elements are removed from normal document flow, they still affect the elements that come after them, something that comes in very handy when building layouts. The float property has two specific values, left and right. A floated element shifts either to the left or to the right until its outer edge reaches the edge of its containing block or another floated element. Elements that come after a floated element act as if it's no longer there and will move up to occupy the now empty space. In some cases, this can lead to the floated element actually overlapping other items on the page. Line boxes, such as individual lines of text, will flow around a floated element, even though the containing block that the lines are inside of actually flows under the floated element. This is best illustrated by imagining text wrapping around an image. Floats will continue to affect any element that comes after them until the float is cleared. Now, we'll discuss clearing later. For right now, let's tackle some of the basics of floating. So here I have the floating.htm file open, and this is found in the 10.03 folder. Let's take a quick look at the structure of our page. Inside of our page, we have three div tags. One has an ID of box 1, the other has an ID of box 2, and the last one has an ID of box number 3. As you can see, we already have some styles that are defining the width and the height of the boxes, and we also have some margins placed on the bottom of them to hold the boxes apart from each other. Well, let's go ahead and float our first element. So I'm going to go up to my CSS styles and highlight the selector pound box 1. That's our first div tag. Go ahead and add a property here, and you want to add the float property, and we're just going to float that to the left. And if you grab the pull-down menu, you can see that you have left, right, none, or inherit. So really, those two values are what you're going to be choosing between left and right. I'm going to go ahead and choose left. And as soon as I do that, something really, really odd happens to our layout. Box 1 doesn't seem to move at all. In fact, it's just where it was before. Box 2, on the other hand, seems to have gone missing. Well, at least part of it's gone missing. And box 3 has moved up as well. So what happened here? Well, what happened was box number 1 was removed from normal document flow. Think of somebody just taking something off the page and picking it up so that it hovers over the page. Box 2 and 3, no longer seeing a box above them, moved up to occupy that space. So why are we still seeing the text for box number 2? Well, we're seeing the text because the containing element went up underneath the parent, but the text itself would wrap around the floated element. And that's what we were talking about earlier when we were talking about what happened to those inline boxes. Well, let's change it to float right and see if it looks any different. So go back to the same selector, choose box one, float that to the right. And yeah, that looks a little different. Now, box two and box three are still moving up to occupy that space, but because they are no longer touching or interacting with box one at all, the inline boxes move up as well, and they're not trying to wrap around the element. Now, let's make another more drastic change. I'm going to take box number one and float it back to the left. Go ahead and highlight the selectors for box two and box three, and for both of those, add a float left property as well. Now what's happening is it looks like we have a single line of elements, when in fact we know from the structure that we have three block level elements, one after another. What's happening is that remember that floated elements are going to go all the way over until they reach the edge of their containing element, or until they reach another floated element. So in this case, there is plenty of room for box one, box two, and box three to all fit on the same line. Now, this is very similar to some techniques that we do when building menus, for example. We'll take the menu items and float them to the left to form a horizontal menu bar. You could also think of these boxes as being larger, taller elements, and we're very close to having a three-column layout. So you can see how flexible floats are when creating different types of layout elements on the page. Now, let's change this a little bit more to reflect a layout that you guys might be a little bit more used to seeing. I'm going to go up to box one, and I'm going to take the float property, and I'm going to get rid of it. The easiest way to do this is to simply click on the float itself, make sure that's highlighted in blue, and then click the trash can icon in the CSS styles panel. Now, the reason that I cautioned you to make sure that this was highlighted in blue is that if you don't, you could delete the whole rule, and you don't want to do that. You want to make sure you're just deleting that property. Now, what happens is box two and box three continue to float, but box one is left alone. Floats only affect the elements below them. So with box number one being part of normal document flow, and box two and box three floating, box two and box three are affected by the floats. Box one could care less. I'm going to take box one and change its width from 100 pixels to 600 pixels. Now I'm going to highlight box number two. I'm going to leave its width at 100 pixels, but I'm also going to give it a margin to the right. So I'm going to add a property here, and I'm going to say margin dash right 25 pixels. Notice how that's pushing one floated element away from the other one. So instead of going all the way to the edge of the floated element, it hits the margin first and it creates sort of a gutter between those two elements. I'm going to change its height to 600 pixels. Finally, I'm going to go to box number three. And here we're going to change its height to 600 pixels as well. And I'm going to change its width to 475 pixels. So now this should seem fairly familiar to you. This is a very basic CSS-based layout. We have a single area up top that would typically be used as a header. Then we have a left column and a right column. The left column could be a sidebar or navigation. The right column would be the majority of your content. This is a very common layout technique, and although there are certainly variations on it, this is very widely used in websites all across the web. So in this movie, we've discussed the very basics of floating. However, this is by no means all you need to know in order to control floats. In any float-based layout, you'll find yourself quite often needing to restore the normal document flow. And that's where clearing comes in. In our next movie, we'll move a step closer to building simple page layouts by discussing clearing and how it is often used in the context of page layouts. There will be times when creating float-based layouts that you want the floated elements to no longer affect the elements that follow them. In our own layout, for example, the main content region and the sidebar are using floats to achieve a two-column layout. We don't want, or even need, the footer to be overlapped by our floated elements. Towards that end, we'll apply a clear to our layout. Clearing floats is an essential technique for achieving reliable float-based layouts. It's your way of saying, that's it. Those floated elements shouldn't float any element past this point. The clear CSS property has three possible values, left, right, and both. By clearing to the left or to the right, you're essentially saying that nothing can float to the left or right of the cleared element. a clear value of both says that no element may float the cleared element, whether it's to the right or to the left. Once floats are cleared, normal document flow continues, and cleared elements will continue to push down in response to the elements above them, even floated elements. In this sample layout, we're going to clear the footer element, which will move it down below our floated elements into the desired location. So let's take a moment to review our page structure. And here I have the clearing.htm file open. So we have a wrapper div tag, which wraps all the other content on the page. We're using auto margins so that the wrapper is centered on the page regardless of the size. Now inside the wrapper div tag, we have a div with an ID of header. It's followed with a div with an ID of main content. Further down the page, we have a div with an ID of sidebar. And then finally, we have a div with an ID of footer. Now, as you can tell, we have some very basic CSS properties set here. We have some height set, we have background colors, we have some text colors, but other than that, we really aren't doing anything with the layout. So I'm going to scroll back up to the top, and we're going to start our layout by floating the main content. Now, in this case, we want the main content to be on the right-hand side, and we want the sidebar to be on the left-hand side. Now, there are a couple of different ways that we can do this. As a matter of fact, if you look at two float-based layouts that are exactly the same, chances are their CSS might be significantly different. So there are a lot of different techniques for doing what we're about to do here. I'm going to select the pound main content selector over here in the CSS styles panel, and I want to add a property to that. I'm going to go ahead and add the float property, and I'm going to float that to the right. That's going to float the main content over to the right-hand side, and you can see the sidebar moves up to occupy the space that the main content used to be in. Now, one thing that you're really not seeing here is that if the main content's background color was transparent, you would actually see that sort of light periwinkle, I guess, sidebar color go up underneath the main content. So there's actually overlap going on here now. Now, one thing I neglected to mention earlier is that our wrapper div tag is 800 pixels wide. So now, when we put our main content on the right-hand side and our sidebar on the left-hand side, one of the things that we want to do is set a width for those that is going to calculate out to that 800 pixels wide of our wrapper. That way we know exactly how much area we have in the main content and the sidebar for any content that we may place in there later. So I'm going to go back to our main content, and I'm going to add a property to this, and I'm going to add the width property. And in this case, I'm going to make it 500 pixels wide. So that extends the main content out a little bit, and now we see the sidebar on the left-hand side, the main content on the right-hand side. Now, I'd like to point out one more thing, too. If you're going to use floating for layouts, whenever you float an element, a best practice is to establish a width for that element as well. That's going to prevent a number of problems in certain browsers. All right, next I want to go down to my sidebar. I'm going to select my sidebar, and I'm going to click to add a property here. I'm going to add the float property, and this time, instead of floating to the right, I'm going to float the sidebar to the left. It moves it over to the left-hand side of the page, and now the sidebar is on the left, all the way up against the edge of its parent element, which in this case is the wrapper. The main content is floated to the right, all the way up against its parent element edge, which in this case is the wrapper. Now, the sidebar is a lot narrower than the main content, but we still need to increase its width a little bit just so we don't have this big gap in the middle of them as we have here. Now, you might be wondering, hey, when is he going to say something about that footer? Yeah, that footer does not look right at all. Let's finish off our sidebar, and we'll talk about what's going on with that footer. So I'm going to add a property here, and I want to go ahead and add a width value, and I'm going to give it 280 pixels worth of width. Those values were arrived at in thinking about what I wanted for this particular layout. We have 800 pixels worth of space from side to side here. By giving 500 pixels here and 280 pixels here, we're left with a total of 20 pixels. That 20 pixels becomes the gutter between the sidebar and the main content region. So in this case, there's no need for us to worry about padding or margins to try to keep those two elements away from each other. The width is going to do it for us. Now, back to that poor footer. Okay, so now it's even worse because the footer doesn't have any room to show up. When we scroll down, the text of the footer is actually down here. You can't see it because it's white and it's on the white background of the wrapper div tag. However, the sort of brown background color of the footer is readily apparent. So what happens? Well, the footer is going to move up because two elements above it are floated. So it moves up to occupy the space that those elements used to occupy in the normal document flow. So our normal document flow now just says header and footer. It doesn't say header, main content, sidebar, footer, because main content and sidebar are floated and thus removed from the normal document flow. So in order to get our footer to locate in the right place, that would be at the very bottom of the layout down here, we need to re-establish that normal document flow. And the way to do that is by using clearing. So I'm going to go to my footer selector over here in CSS styles. I'm going to add a property to that, and I'm going to add a clear property. Now, if I grab the pull-down menu for clear, I can see that I have left, right, and both. Now, the main content is floated to the right, and the sidebar is floated to the left. So I really can't choose one over the other. I need to go ahead, in this case, choose both. So I'm going to choose both, and hey, look what happens. Our footer reappears at the bottom of the page because now we have reestablished normal document flow. The footer is no longer allowing any element to float to its left, and it's no longer allowing any element to float to its right. Because of that, normal document flow is reestablished. So essentially what happens is the header is in normal document flow. Main content and sidebar temporarily interrupt that as one flows to the right and one flows to the left. But then the footer reestablishes normal document flow by clearing the floats and saying, no, I'm not going to be affected by either of those two guys above me. Now, the really nice thing about this particular technique is that if the height of the main content region or the height of the sidebar increases, the footer is going to continue to push down the page because it will never allow one of the two of them to float. So, for example, if I go to main content and I make its height, say, 600 pixels. You know, if we scroll down, we can see that the main content is pushing the footer down. This is exactly what we need for a two-column layout that has a header and a footer. So by clearing floats, we can reestablish normal document flow, contain floats, and help our layout take shape. If you become familiar with these techniques, you'll understand how the overwhelming majority of CSS-based layouts are created. Now, keep in mind, this is a very simple, very basic layout, but also an amazingly common one. A header, two columns of content, and a footer has become a standard for many types of web pages. Using floats and clearing them when necessary is a quick and easy way to achieve most of your layout requirements. Of course, we've just scratched the surface of what you need to know when floating elements. For more information on floats and clearing and containing those floats, please consult the other CSS titles in the lynda.com online training library. I cover floats and controlling them in much more detail in my Dreamweaver CSS Essential titles. Now that we've discussed floats, we're going to discuss using the CSS position property to tweak our layouts and increase the control we have over individual elements within our pages. In addition to floating elements, you can specify element placement by using the position style property. The position attribute has three values: relative, absolute, and fixed. The default value is considered to be static, which can be explicitly stated if you need to overwrite another value. Unlike absolute or fixed positioning, relative positioning is still considered part of normal document flow, and the positioned elements are treated as such. Relative positioning basically offsets an element relative to where it would be normally found within the page. We can set left, top, right, and bottom values to control its location. The space originally occupied by the element is left untouched and behaves as if the element is still there. This can sometimes create a hole in your document where the element used to be. Other items in your layout still react to it when the positioned element is modified, and the empty space that marks its original location will expand or contract based on that. Well, let's take a look at that in action. Here we have the relative positioning.htm file open from the 10.0.5 folder. We have three div tags on the page. They're identified as box 1, box 2, and box 3, and they each have a paragraph inside of them. If we look over our CSS styles, we have some very generic styles that are styling our divs and the paragraph inside the div, but nothing that's driving any of the individual boxes, so we're going to have to create those. So I'm going to add a brand new CSS rule, and I'm just going to go ahead and make this an ID selector, and I'm going to do pound box 1. So we're going to position the box 1 element, and we'll go ahead and define it in this document only. Go ahead and click OK. Now, if you go down to your categories and you go to the positioning category, you can see the position attribute right here. If you grab the pull-down menu, Notice that we can choose between absolute, fixed, relative, and static. For this exercise, we're going to choose relative. So after relative positioning, if we want to offset it, we can use any of the placement values. We can offset it by the top, the right, the bottom, and the left. Now, if you offset something using the right value, the right edge of the object will be offset from the right edge of the containing element. If you use left, the left edge of the element is going to be offset from the left edge of the containing element. The same is true for top and bottom. So typically, you're going to use them in conjunction with top and or right or left, and bottom and or right or left, but you probably won't use more than two of them at a time. So here, we're just going to do a left offset. And I'm going to give this a left offset of 150 pixels. Now I'm going to go ahead and click OK, and watch what happens to our layout. Box 1 moves to the right, but box 2 and box 3 are totally unaffected by this. This is very different than floats. If I would have floated box 1 to the right, box 2 and box 3 would have moved up to occupy the empty space. But with relative positioning, the other elements on the page still assume that the first element is there. In fact, if we go to box 1 and increase its height value, so let's make its height, say, 200 pixels, notice that it pushes 2 and 3 down correspondingly. So relative positioning might seem fairly easy, but as layouts get more complex, it's difficult to remember where an element's original position is supposed to be. Trying to keep track of which element is going to respond to other elements being modified can be a nightmare. Because of this, page layouts are not created using only relative positioning. Rather, relative positioning is used more to tweak or nudge elements within your existing document flow. Now, relative positioning has another, more common use for page layout as well. It's very common to set an element's positioning attribute to relative and then not offset it. This allows the element to act as a parent element for any absolutely positioned elements inside of it. That might not make a whole lot of sense right now, but it will when we discuss absolute positioning in our next movie. Absolute positioning, unlike relative positioning, removes the element from normal document flow. Other elements in the document that come after it move up as if the element doesn't exist. The positioned element is then placed precisely where you want it using a combination of left, top, right, or bottom offset values. The trick is to know which point you're positioning it from. Absolutely positioned elements are moved in relation to the closest parent element that has a position attribute. If no such element exists, then the top parent element, which is usually the body tag, is used instead. This is why it's so common to have parent elements that merely have a positioned attribute of relative with no other offset values. Now, that sounds pretty abstract until you actually see it in action, so we're going to go ahead and do an exercise here where we do absolute positioning and we understand the relationship that their parent elements have to the positioned element itself. So I have the index.htm file open here, and this is found in the 1006 folder. Now, we're getting a little bit closer to our Explore California layout. This is, for the most part, all of the structural elements of our Explore California page. We have our header here in the top left-hand corner. It's encased within a div with an ID of wrapper. And then below that, we have our main content, our main nav, our sidebar, and our footer. And right now, those elements are floated to achieve their layout look. But for the header element, we need everybody else to move up to occupy the space where the header is now. And then we're going to use the header and overlap our layout with it. So absolute positioning is a really good choice for doing that. So what we're going to do is go over to our CSS styles panel, and I might extend this a little bit so I can see a few more of these. I'm looking for this selector right here, the header. And if you'd like, you could go ahead and double-click that to open up the CSS rule definition dialog box. You could certainly add the properties manually in the panel as well. So I'm going to go over to my categories here and click on the positioning category, and we're going to choose a position of absolute for this. Now, the offset values that we're going to give it here are a little different than in some cases. We're going to go ahead and give it a left offset of 35 pixels. Now, remember, that should move it 35 pixels to the right because you're going to offset the left edge from the leftmost edge of its parent element. But for the top value, here's where we're going to do something a little different. That's going to get a value of negative 25 pixels. Now, a negative top value, instead of pushing an element down the page, will pull an element up the page. So if you want to overlap something and move something up from another element, using negative offsets is a good way to do that. Now, if I go ahead and click OK and do a Save All, we don't really see any change occurring except for the header just seems to disappear. Well, Design View is not going to do a great job of showcasing to us what's going on here, so I'm going to switch over to Live View. Now, in Live View, we can see that our header has moved over and up a little bit, and then all the rest of the content on the page has moved up as well. Now, in order to really illustrate what's happening here, I need to be able to resize this. So what I'm going to do is preview this in my browser. So any browser should work here. I'm going to use Firefox. And now we see maybe not quite the desired result that we were thinking. If I grab my browser and resize it, I can see that the remainder of the layout's kind of moving around with that. It's centered within the window, so as I resize that layout, all the main content, the sidebar, all those elements are moving along with it. But the header is staying fixed in that location. Now, the reason for that is exactly what we were talking about earlier. The header is going to go up to its parent element, and it's going to ask, do you have a positioning attribute? If that value is no, it's just going to keep going up the document tree until somebody finally says yes. If nobody ever says yes, then it ends at the body tag, and it says, okay, you are my parent element. And so now what we're seeing is this header element offsetting itself 35 pixels from the left edge of the parent containing element. And then it's actually going up a little bit. If we could see kind of behind this toolbar right here, the top of our header would be right here because it's going negative 25 pixels up. Okay, well, that's not where we want it. We want it to occupy this space right here. The way to do that is to make sure that it's positioning itself relative to the wrapper div tag and not the body div tag. So how do we do that? Well, pretty easy. We go right back to our CSS styles. We find our wrapper div tag. And then with our wrapper div tag, we give it a positioning attribute as well, but this time we give it a relative positioning attribute. Now, if you remember from the relative positioning movie, this is going to keep the wrapper as part of the normal document flow. Relatively positioned elements are not removed from normal document flow, so it shouldn't have any adverse effect on our layout at all. We're also not going to give it any type of an offset, so we're not going to give it any top values or left values or right values. We're just going to leave it alone. So what that in effect is going to do is everybody else will ignore that relative positioning, but the header is going to say, oh, okay, so you have a positioning attribute, and it will now position itself relative to the wrapper div tag. So I'm going to go ahead and click OK, save the file, and preview that in my browser again. Now we can see the header is positioning itself just 25 pixels above the wrapper div tag, which is butting it right up against the top of our browser window, and 35 pixels from the left of the wrapper div tag itself. Resizing the browser window now means that that object goes right along with it. Now, as we mentioned before, absolute positioning removes it from normal document flow, and everybody else moves up to occupy that space. You can see this with main content. Main content's now moving up to the very top of the wrapper div tag and butting up against the top right edge. However, our main nav and our sidebar aren't moving up underneath the header div tag like we would expect. Why not? Well, it's a little bit of trickery there. What we've done is we've placed enough of a top margin on main nav to push it this far down. So normally it would move up and under the header div tag, but in this case we've given ourselves enough top margin to give us the illusion of the fact that the header is pushing it down, but in reality it's not. So absolute positioning is fairly straightforward. The upside to using it is that you can position elements with pixel level precision. The downside is that the element is removed from normal flow, so it no longer interacts with other elements. In fact, it will overlap other elements on the page, making it impossible to have a layout that relies heavily on absolute positioning, unless every element will be a fixed width and height and never change. For most layouts, absolute positioning is used as it is here, to position elements within their parent containers. It's also worth noting that you can change the stacking order of absolutely positioned elements by using the z-index property. The higher the index value, the higher the stacking order. So if you need to make sure an element is on top of other elements, you could simply give it a high z-index value. Our site will feature a twist on a popular and very basic layout structure. We'll have a header, followed by the main navigation, and this will be followed by the main content region, a sidebar, and then finally, a footer. Every page in our site will follow this layout, meaning that we will be able to build one set of styles to control our layout and then use those styles on every single page. that allows us to write very efficient code and build a consistent structure. You may remember that div tags will give our page structure and form these content regions. ID values will be assigned to the div tags to pass along meaning and aid in the styling process. As a general rule, I will create and style these div tags before any other content appears on my page. That way, I can make sure the layout is working and that the structure is sound before committing content to the page itself. In this movie, we'll begin to create our layout from scratch. To do this, we'll use Dreamweaver's tools to quickly add div tags to our page, adding IDs and styles as we go. So I have the index.htm file open from the 1007 folder. And currently, we just have a blank page. There is nothing in here whatsoever other than the body tag itself. Now, we do have one style that is currently giving a background color to the body tag, and that's just going to help us make sure that we have proper definition for all the elements on the page as we begin to add them. Okay, now, I'm going to show you a tool here that I absolutely love. Now, to be honest with you, some of you guys are going to be very comfortable hand coding, and you could go into Code View and you could do what we're about to do here in a much quicker fashion. However, the tool that I'm going to show you guys is the Insert Div Tag tool. It's right up here in the Insert panel. And the thing that I really like about this is that even though we're in Design View, we're going to be able to create div tags that are going to go into our content. We're going to be able to precisely control where those div tags are going to be located. And we're going to be able to assign an ID or class and write the style for that ID or class as we insert it on the page. So that allows you to tackle a lot of tasks at one time, which is why I like this tool so much. So what I'm going to do is just go up, and with my cursor blinking anywhere on the page, it doesn't matter, I'm going to click to insert a div tag. Now at this point, saying add insertion point doesn't really matter. I mean, there's nothing on the page. So it's going to go inside the body tag, which is perfect. Now notice that we have a couple of dialog boxes here. The first one allows us to assign a class value, and the second allows us to assign an ID attribute. So we could assign a class or an ID attribute with this dialog box. Now, if we currently had an attached style sheet that had pre-existing classes or pre-existing IDs, we could actually grab them from this pull-down menu. Now, we don't have any styles written whatsoever, so it's empty. But that's what is so neat about this new CSS rule option. That allows you to create and write your CSS as you're assigning the ID and inserting the div tag on the page. So it allows you to do that all at one time. So if I click inside the ID field here and I type in the word wrapper, when I choose new CSS rule, notice that it already knows that, oh, you need an ID selector and you're going to name it pound wrapper. So you're going ahead and taking care of a lot of steps all at once. Now I'm going to go ahead and define this rule in this document only. I'm going to go ahead and click OK. And instead of writing all of our layout CSS right now, we're just concerned with building the structure. So we're only going to put a couple of properties in here to allow us to identify these regions, and then we're going to come back in a later exercise and actually write the CSS for them. So the first thing I want to do here is go to my background property, and I'm going to give this a background of pound FFF. That's white. And then I'm going to go to the box category, and I'm going to go ahead and give this a width of 930 pixels. And that's what we need for our wrapper div tag. Our page content is going to be constrained within 930 pixels. I'm going to go ahead and click OK, and OK again. Now, what happens is, all at once, the CSS style wrapper is created over here in our CSS styles panel, and our div tag is placed on the page. You can see that Dreamweaver gives you some placeholder content for that particular div tag. Content for ID wrapper goes here. Well, that's very useful if you're building out your entire structure and you want to know where the header is, where the sidebar is, where the main content region is. But for the wrapper, all it really does is wrap all of our other div tags, so we don't need that. So I'm going to go ahead and highlight that text and just delete it to sort of get it out of the way. Be very careful. Make sure you don't have the entire div tag selected. So just highlight that text. You want the div tag to remain. Okay, now we're going to go through and add the remainder of our divs and go ahead and build styles for them at the same time. I'm going to go ahead and insert another div tag on the page. And this time, where we insert it really does matter. We want to make sure that this is inside the wrapper div tag. So what we're going to do is grab this pull-down menu, and instead of saying before tag or after tag, we're going to say after the start of tag. And we're going to say after the start of wrapper. So after the opening wrapper div tag, we're going to insert a div tag. And so it'll be between the opening and closing tags, meaning that this div tag will be inside of the wrapper tag. So you want to make sure it says after start of tag, div ID equals wrapper. And we're going to give this one an ID of header and choose new CSS rule. Once again, we're going to double check to make sure it is an ID selector. It should say pound header, and we want to define it in this document only. We're going to go ahead and click OK. We're going to give this one a background color as well. Now, the background colors we're putting in here, and this one's going to be pound FFC, they really don't mean anything. They're just placeholder colors to help us identify these regions of content. Later on, we'll replace them with graphics or other colors. I'm going to go down to the box category, and here we're going to give this one a width of 192 pixels, and we're going to give it a height of 237 pixels. The header is where our company logo is eventually going to go, and so that width and height is the exact width and height of the company logo. I'm going to go ahead and click OK, click OK again, and now right after the start of our wrapper div tag, and you can kind of see it's definitely inside of it because there's our white background color of our wrapper, there's the header. Okay, well, let's keep going. And it doesn't really matter where you click because now we can use those insert div tag controls to make sure we're inserting them in the right place. So I'm going to choose insert div tag. This time I'm going to choose after tag. And the tag this one's going to come after is the header. So we're just going to do these in order from this point forward. It'll be after the previous tag that you just wrote. In this case, this ID is going to be main nav. Notice that is all one word, lowercase m, uppercase n. This means that if somebody's viewing our unstyled content, after the header, we want them to encounter the main navigation. We'll choose new CSS rule, verify that everything looks good here, ID, main nav, this document only, everything looks good. I'll click OK. And now what we're going to do is give this one a background color of pound 00F. I'm going to go to the box category, give it a width of 272 pixels, and give it a height of 200 pixels. Now, the height is just there to show volume, but the 272 pixels is important. The main navigation and the sidebar are going to stack one on top of the other. They're both going to be 272 pixels wide, and they're going to look as if they're a single column. But because of the way that we want the content to be encountered, main navigation first, main content second, sidebar third, we're going to be a little sneaky in how we actually construct it. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and click OK here, OK again. And now there's the div tag main nav. Let's keep going. Insert another div tag. This time we're going to be after the main nav tag. Now make sure it says after tag and not after start. It's easy to confuse the two. And after tag means after the entire tag and not inside of the tag as after start of tag would be. So make sure you say after tag there. Div ID main nav. Now the next one is going to be main content. Here we're going to choose new CSS rule. Verify everything looks okay, ID, main content, this document only. And for this one, the background color is going to be pound CCF. Now, if you want to use different background colors, be my guest. I know these don't follow any great color scheme. They're really just there to show the elements, and they're designed to contrast with each other. So if you find them visually unappealing, please go ahead and put in your own. Now, in the box category, we're going to go ahead and give this a width of 608 pixels. Now, that is the width that we need for our main content region, but the height, and in this case is going to be 600 pixels, is again just to show volume. So we'll go ahead and click OK again. There we get our main content. We're almost done. I'm going to do insert div tag again. This time we're going to do after tag, main content. So you can see we're just going down there in order. And the ID of this one is going to be sidebar. Now be sure to click new CSS rule. And we want this to be ID, pound sidebar, this document only. That's fine. Click OK. Background for this one, I'm going to use pound CC2. I'm going to go to the box category. And in the box category, I'm going to give that a width of 272 pixels and a height of 300 pixels. Now, remember, 272 was the exact same width as the main nav. So when those two sort of stack one on top of each other, they're going to look like a single column. I'll go ahead and click OK. Click OK again. And now we have one last div tag container that we need. I'm going to insert div tag. This one is going to be after the sidebar that we just placed in. So after tag, div ID equals sidebar. And we're going to give this one an ID of footer. And then click new CSS rule. So make sure it's an ID selector, pound footer, this document only. Go ahead and click OK. Now here for the background, I'm just going to put in pound 0EE, sort of a bright blue aqua color. And for the box category, go ahead and give it a width of 930 pixels. That is exactly the same width as our wrapper div tag, and give it a height of 200 pixels. Click OK again, and there is the footer. Now, that doesn't look very good at all, but it is exactly the structure that we need for our page layout. If we switch over to code view, you can see how simple this structure is. We have a wrapper div tag, which is surrounding a header, followed by a main navigation, followed by main content, followed by a sidebar, followed by a footer. Those five elements are going to give us all we need for our main page layout. So even though we're a long way away from having our layout finished, we can at least see the basic structure of the site. Many of the things that we've created, like background colors and a lot of the heights, won't be part of our final layout. They do, however, give us the ability to preview our content areas as we're building the layout. Now, if you don't feel like adding these temporary items to your styles, let me show you something that Dreamweaver can do for you to preview those areas. I'm going to switch back to design view, and if we didn't have any of these background colors, and we were just kind of wondering where do these elements fit in, you can go to your visual aids right here in the document toolbar, and you can choose CSS layout backgrounds. They're essentially going to color code all of the elements on the page with their own custom colors. Now, it's interesting because they're different every time. You never know what you're going to get. They use a random algorithm, so if you turn them off and turn them back on again, you get a different set of colors. Really, all they're designed to do is show you where those regions of content are and contrast them with the other regions on the page. So if you don't feel like putting in those sort of placeholder background colors that we've done, you could use that technique instead. Now, I also would like to point out that although we could have certainly hand-coded our page just as quickly, I really do like this technique because it allows me to precisely position my div tags and create styles as I build the structure. In our next movie, we're going to add floats and a positioning attribute that's going to create our main layout. Along the way, we'll discuss our layout choices and why attributes are used for specific elements. In our last movie, we focused on creating the basic structure of our site layout. Although we did write some basic CSS for our regions, they were more so that we could visualize them within the layout rather than being part of our final layout. In this movie, we're going to write the CSS that's going to focus on our container elements and the basic positioning attributes, leaving the creation of our two column layout for our next movie. In both movies, we will focus not only on using the layout techniques we've learned so far, but also on the organization and overall strategies of our layout CSS. So here we have our index.htm from the 10.08 folder, and we're kind of picking up right where we left off. In our last movie, we went ahead and built the structure of this and put in some placeholder CSS. Well, we want to write some more robust CSS in this movie and write the CSS that's going to control our actual Explore California layout. So we're going to work with the same basic structural elements that we had before, and I'm just going to come over here to the CSS styles panel, maybe pull that divider down a little bit so I can see these guys a little bit better. And I want to talk about some of the styles that we're going to be writing. Now, the first style we're going to be writing is actually a new style to this, and what we're going to be doing is dealing with the fact that all browsers out there have default margins and padding that they use for the body tag. It offsets the page slightly from the top in the left corner of the browser itself, and all browsers are slightly different. So if you want a consistent positioning, either left to right or top to bottom, a good idea is to go ahead and zero those out. So what I'm going to do is go over to my CSS styles, and I'm going to click the body tag. It's the top level tag, and I just want to create a rule close to that one. And I'm going to choose new CSS rule. Now here, I'm going to grab the selector type and choose compound. Remember, compound allows me to type in pretty much whatever I want. Here, I'm going to type in HTML, comma, body. So that is a grouped selector, and it's grouping both the HTML element selector and the body element selector. So why are we doing that? Well, it's interesting. Most browsers view the body tag as the parent tag. But there are some browsers who view the HTML element as its top-level parent tag. So in that case, we're going to go ahead and write a selector that applies to both of them. So no matter what browser we're in, we're zeroing out those default margins and padding. So I'm going to go ahead and click OK. I'm going to go to my box category. And for padding, I'll type in 0, same for all. Margin 0, same for all. And I'm going to go ahead and click OK. Now notice what happens to our page layout. It aligns to the top of the document window and to the left of the document window, indicating that there are no default margins and paddings affecting our page. Perfect. Now, the next thing we need to do is refine our body tag selector a little bit. So I'm going to go over to my CSS styles panel, double-click the body tag, and we're just going to make a couple of general changes here. Now, the first thing I'm going to do is go to my box properties. And here, I'm going to deselect same for all for margin, but I'm going to give this a top margin of 25 pixels. Now, you're probably sitting here wondering, wait a minute, I thought we just took the margin off of the body tag. Here you are, putting it right back again. Well, what we did with the previous rule is remove the default margins and padding. Now we're explicitly telling every single browser out there we want our body tag to push everything down by about 25 pixels. That's going to give us a little bit of space between the top of our page and the top of the browser window. And for the layout that we're doing, that is exactly what we want. Next, we're going to go to the block category, and we're going to do something that for some of you guys might be a little unexpected. We're going to change our text align property to center. And to which a lot of you might reply, what? Well, what's happening here is that we want our page layout centered on the page. Older versions of Internet Explorer have a little bit of a problem with the technique that we're going to use to do this. To center our layout on the page, we're going to use auto margins on our wrapper div tag. Well, since older versions of Internet Explorer have a harder time dealing with that, we use text align center on the parent tag. That's going to move everything to the center of the page in those older versions of IE, but it has the downside of physically centering all of our text, so in another selector, we're going to have to deal with that. One last thing here. We're going to change the background property for our body tag, too. We want to display a background graphic that's going to give the illusion of a gradient going from blue to sort of a sand color. So we're going to change our background color to pound E1D8B9, so E1D8B9. If you hit tab, you'll see it's sort of a light tan color there, or maybe a little bit of a sand color. Now, the background image we're going to put in, I'm just going to browse for this, and I'm going to make sure I'm in the 1008 folder. I'm going to go in the images directory, and what I'm looking for is this page background.jpg. So you want to browse down and find page_background.jpg. Now, this is interesting. If we look at this in the little preview window over here, we can see that it is 1,600 pixels tall, but only 10 pixels wide. So it's a really small graphic, but it's really big in terms of its height. Now, how in the world is that going to give us the illusion that we have this sort of solid gradient going down the page? Well, I'm going to click OK here, but then what I'm going to do is for the background repeat, I'm going to grab the pull-down menu and choose Repeat X. That means instead of tiling this background graphic, which would be the default, it's only going to repeat it along the x-axis, so it's going to repeat it over and over and over again horizontally, but not vertically. When we click OK, we can kind of see that in action. I'm just going to kind of scroll down the page. You can see the gradient, and then it finally fades out to that sort of sand color. So no matter how tall the page gets, that sand color will sort of be there down at the bottom, but as they scroll up, they'll have that gradient fading into the blue. So it's kind of a nice way to achieve that effect. All right, the next thing we need to do is center our page layout in the browser window. We're going to do that by taking advantage of the fact that our page layout has a wrapper div tag. This wrapper becomes kind of the container for our entire page, and is typically used to control the remainder of the layout. So I'm going to go to the pound wrapper right here, double-click that, and there are just a few changes we want to make here. Now, the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to go down to the box category. This is where we're going to make the majority of our changes here. Our width is 930 pixels, and that's fine. We don't need to change that at all. What we are going to change is margin, so I'm going to deselect same for all. And for the top margin and the bottom margin, I'm going to type in 0. I don't want any additional margin there. However, for the right and left, I'm going to choose auto. Now, here's what that's going to do. Basically, it's going to say, hey, other than the 930 pixels that I need for my width, anything left over, I want you to automatically split between the right and the left. So it'll calculate the remaining value. It'll put half of it on the left, half of it on the right. That's going to result in our wrapper centering the content right in the middle of the page. Now, remember, we still have that sort of messy text align center that we placed on the body. Well, here's where we reset that. So I'm going to go right to the block category, and I'm going to choose text align left. That's going to reset basically all of our text alignment so that anything within our wrapper will be left aligned. I'm going to click OK, and there we go. The wrapper now centers within that page, our text align is left, and we're still focused at 930 pixels wide. Perfect. Now, the last thing we're going to do here before we tackle our two-column layout in the next movie is address our header. So our header needs to be positioned just up and to the right of the remainder of the page, and this is where our logo is going to go. So we're going to use absolute positioning to do this. Now, if you remember from the absolute positioning movie, were we to use absolute positioning on the header right now, we wouldn't achieve our desired result. The reason for that is because the wrapper div tag doesn't have a position attribute, so it would use the body tag to determine where it should appear in our browser window. Well, we need to change that. So let's go back to our wrapper one more time. we're going to go down to positioning, and we're going to choose position relative. Now, I know plenty of people who just do this automatically. Anytime they have a container or a wrapper div tag, regardless of whether they are at that time planning on doing any positioning inside of it, they'll just go ahead and give it a position relative anyway. A lot of times it'll fix some of those Internet Explorer bugs caused by the has layout problem. And they also go ahead and give you the foundation of saying anything that you position inside of me will be relative to me and not the body tag. So now we're going to go ahead and click OK, and we won't really see any visual change there. Well, next, let's go ahead and finish up by positioning our header. I'm going to double-click the header selector, and the first thing we're going to do now is go down to the positioning category. Well, here we need to change this to position absolute. Our width and our height are fine, so we don't need to change that, but we are going to be doing some offsets here. Our top offset is going to be negative 25 pixels. Now, if you remembered earlier, we applied 25 pixels worth of margin to our body. So essentially what we're saying here is we want our header to move back up and align with the very top of the browser window. We're also going to give it a left offset of 35 pixels. That's going to push it 35 pixels over to the right of the edge of our wrapper div tag. Now, that's really all we need to do here, but while we're at it, why don't we go ahead and place our background image inside of our header? We could certainly place an image tag in here, but this is purely for visual reasons. There's no reason for us to pass the picture of our logo to any type of screen reader or any other user agent, so let's go ahead and use a background image here. So I'm going to go to background. I'm going to delete the existing background color, and then I'm going to browse for our background image. Now I want to go in the 1008 images directory and find the logo.gif. Notice that it is 192 pixels wide, 237 pixels tall. That is the exact same measurement that we gave for this div tag. So that's going to give it enough space to display the entire logo. I'm going to click OK. And just as we did with the page's background image, we're going to control how this background image repeats. However, unlike the page's background image, we don't want any tiling at all. We only want this logo to show up once. So for background repeat, I'm going to go ahead and choose no dash repeat. That says only show this once and don't tile it ever again. We'll click OK. Well, the majority of our layout styles are now finished. We're removing the default page margins that might affect our layout, using the wrapper div tag to define the width of the page and center our content on the page, and we're using absolute positioning to style our header and place our logo visually on the page. Next, we'll need to finish our layout by creating two columns through floating, and we'll tackle that in our next movie. Our Explore California layout is almost finished. Now we need to create the two-column layout using our main content, main navigation, and sidebar. Remember that the main navigation and sidebar need to look like they're part of the same column, even though they're separated by the main content region. We'll achieve this by floating the main content right and the sidebar and the main navigation to the left. We'll also have to take special care to make sure that the sidebar and the main navigation areas never overlap or appear beside each other. We'll do this, as well as assuring that the footer is going to remain in place, by clearing our floats as well. So I have the index file open, and you can see we're sort of picking up where we left off. We still have some placeholder content here and there, so if you want to get rid of that content for ID header goes here text, you can do that, because that doesn't need to be there anymore. And now we need to concentrate on our main nav, main content, and sidebar. Now we can see, because of the fact that our Explore California header logo is being absolutely positioned, everybody else has just moved up to occupy the space that it used to be in. And the first element, which is the blue one right here, is our main navigation, and that is the first one that we're going to go ahead and start laying out using our floats. So I'm going to go over to the CSS Styles panel. I'm going to double-click main nav, and I'm just going to take care of a couple of properties here. We're going to go to the box property. For float, I'm going to float it to the left. The width at 272 is fine, and I'm actually going to leave the height too. The reason I'm leaving the height is because I just want to show some volume. Again, in your actual layout, you would let the content form the height there. You wouldn't have that explicit value. So if you're ever going to take this layout and kind of do something with this on your own and you want to experiment with it a little bit, be sure to remove that height value so that whatever you place in your navigation will take care of the height for you. And then the next thing we need to do is take care of the fact that the absolute position logo is removed from document flow. So there's nothing that's going to take our main nav area and push it down. So we've got to allow for that. So what we're going to do now is, still in the box category, we're going to deselect same for all for margin, and we're going to give this a top margin of 233 pixels. When I click OK, I can see that that has pushed our main navigation area down, and it leaves us about 20 pixels worth of space between the logo and the main nav, and that's caused by all this margin right up here. Perfect. Now let's go to our main content region and position it on the right-hand side of our page. So let's go over to our CSS styles, find the main content ID selector, and double-click that. So here we're going to go to the box category as well. And we want to float this to the right. So we're going to float that against the right edge of the page instead of the left. We're going to leave the width at 608 pixels, and we're actually going to leave the height at 600 as well. Again, we're just going to leave that height in there so that there's some volume to this. If we didn't, it would just collapse. But in a real page layout, you would place content inside there, and that would form the height for you. Now, we are going to do a couple of things with margins and padding. So I'm going to deselect Same for All for padding, and I'm going to give it a right padding of 25 pixels. What that's going to do for us is it's going to hold off anything that's in that main content 25 pixels away from the edge of the wrapper. It's going to give us a nice little gutter or a margin, if you will, on the right-hand side. So why aren't we using margin? It's a personal choice. We could use margin there, but there's a bit of a problem with that. In older versions of Internet Explorer, if you float an element to one side and then also give it a margin on that side, you trigger a bug known as the double float margin bug. In that case, we end up with twice the value of the margin we want, and it's going to look terrible in that browser. By using padding here instead of a margin, we're avoiding that bug altogether. Finally, let's go over to our margin, and I'm going to deselect Same for All and do a bottom margin of 45 pixels. That means that any content underneath the main content, such as the footer, is going to continue to be pushed down by about 45 pixels of extra space. That's going to ensure that any content that you place inside the main content won't end up right against the edge of the footer or any other element underneath it. I'm going to go ahead and click OK. And now our main content shows up exactly where we want it. And notice that it has its margin right down there at the bottom. Okay, well, our main nav is being positioned there, but because the main nav and the main content have both been floated, the sidebar, which is this green area, is now coming right up under everybody else. So now we need to go ahead and make sure that our sidebar becomes part of our two-column layout as well. So I'll go over to my CSS styles, find the sidebar, and double-click that. And now I'm going to go back down to our box categories. We're going to float that to the left, and we're going to leave the width at 272 pixels, and I'll just leave the height at 300 pixels, again, just to give it some volume. Now, we are going to do one thing a little bit differently here on the sidebar. In addition to floating the sidebar to the left, we're also going to clear it to the left. Okay, now why are we doing that? Well, remember, we don't want the main navigation and the sidebar to ever show up beside each other. It would break our two-column layout, and it would make it look like a three-column layout. Well, normally that wouldn't happen just because we will probably have enough main content to keep that always sort of on the left-hand side. But what happens if you're dealing with a page that doesn't have a lot of content in it, and you've got a long sidebar and a long main navigation area? Well, what would happen is, if the main content region went up far enough, the sidebar would try to allow the main navigation to float to its left. By telling the sidebar to clear to the left, you're basically telling it, hey, don't ever let anybody float to the left of you, and that's going to keep it below the main navigation and give them the appearance of being stacked one on top of the other. So we're going to go ahead and click OK there, and now if I scroll down, I can see the sidebar, and those guys are stacking one on top of each other. And if it wasn't for their separate background colors, they would look as if they were in one single column. Perfect. Now, our footer is the last thing we need to do. And currently, the footer is just coming right on up underneath everybody else because these guys have all been removed from normal document flow. So I'm going to double-click the footer, and we're going to go ahead and put in some properties for our footer here. Now, we're going to put in more than you think, probably, because we're going to go ahead and put in the background graphic for the footer as well. I'm going to go to our box category, and the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to clear both. That way, the main content that's floating on the right and the sidebar and the main navigation floating on the left will not affect the footer. The footer is going to remain below them. We're basically reestablishing normal document flow. Now, here's where things are going to get a little tricky. It would be really easy to go ahead and leave the width of this at 930 pixels. But I want to give you guys a realistic example of some of the things that you have to deal with when you're dealing with CSS-based layouts. Eventually, our footer is going to have three columns of text in it. It's going to be quite an involved footer. And so because of that, we need to go ahead and allow for the fact that we don't want the content inside of it to butt right up against the edges. So what I'm going to do is deselect Same for All for padding. I'm going to go ahead and give it a top padding of 45 pixels, a right padding of 30 pixels. a bottom padding of 30 pixels, and a left padding of 30 pixels. Now, because of the fact that we're adding 30 pixels to the left and 30 pixels to the right, we're adding an additional 60 pixels worth of width to our footer. So in order to make sure that it's not actually wider than the wrapper itself, we're going to change the width of the footer to 870 pixels. Now, you might be asking, well, why do we have to define the width at all? If it's a block-level element, won't it expand if it's its parent container? You're right, it will. But we want to show a background image, and that background image has a defined width and a defined height. I want to ensure that this is going to be large enough to display that. Speaking of that, we're going to change the height to 525 pixels. So it's going to have a width of 870, a height of 525. Padding is going to be top 45, and then right, bottom, and left will have 30 pixels worth of padding. We're also going to go ahead and add a top margin of 45 pixels on that as well to increase the amount of space above the footer. So everything's looking pretty good. Last thing we need to do here is go ahead and grab the background image for our footer. So I'm going to go to the background category. I'm going to get rid of the background color that we have here, and I'm just going to browse for our background image. And once you're in the 10.9 images directory, you want to browse down and find this image right here, footer_back.gif. Notice it is 930 pixels wide by 600 pixels tall. It's a map of California. It's got some dark blue here where we can place some text on it. And then the tan color right here is going to do a nice job of blending that in with the background. We could have done that by using a ping and having alpha transparency, but really that's a really simple thing to do. So involving transparency in something as simple as that is probably unnecessary. I'm going to go ahead and click OK. We only want to see it once, so for background repeat, it's going to be no repeat. Click OK again, and there's my footer. If I do a save all and preview that in my browser, we can see the very beginnings of our layout. There's our footer, we have our sidebar, our main content region, and our main navigation. Once enough content gets in there to stretch that out, it's going to make the layout blend seamlessly into the background instead of what it's doing here, and we're going to be in really, really good shape. So the only thing our layout needs right now is content placed into the individual regions and then that interior content styled. Now, I know this doesn't look that impressive, but for the most part, main page layout is done. The major page regions are laid out according to our overall strategy. And one thing I want to point out that I haven't talked about yet, notice that we've separated the layout styles from the styles that will follow that are going to control typography and any sort of inner region areas. And this strategy allows us to quickly tweak the main page layout and then quickly find and eliminate any cross-browser issues or style overwrites as we're constructing the rest of our page. Of course, the more you add to the page, the more complicated things become. So in our next series of movies, we're going to explore some of the Dreamweaver tools that you can use to troubleshoot layout issues and refine your styles. Once you get past the initial page layout and start focusing on the individual content regions, the ability to make precise edits and tweaks without negatively affecting the overall design becomes critically important. Inefficient style sheets are usually the result of an individual having difficulty in styling a specific page region. To that end, being able to accurately judge how elements are interacting with one another is crucial to writing clean and accurate styles. Live View and CSS Inspect, both of which are tools in Dreamweaver related to Dreamweaver's WebKit integration, can be of tremendous help when writing your layout styles. WebKit is an open source browser rendering engine used to power multiple browsers, including Google's Chrome and Apple's Safari. Dreamweaver uses WebKit to give you the ability to accurately preview and troubleshoot your designs from within Dreamweaver. In this movie, we'll explore Live View, CSS Inspect, and how they can assist you when writing your styles. So here we have the index.htm page open from the 10.10 folder, and this is more or less our finished layout. All the background images are in place, all the content is in place, and our layout looks pretty much the way that we want it to. Now, in order to properly show off Live View, CSS Inspect, and what they're capable of, I'm going to give myself a little bit of extra screen real estate. I'm going to do that by collapsing my panels down to icons. Remember, you can do that right there, and then you can just go ahead and move that over to take them down further so that no labels show up. And then I'm going to double-click the Properties Inspector. And so now that we've got enough screen real estate to really show Live View off, I'm going to go up to my document toolbar and turn Live View on. Now, as soon as I do that, our page is re-rendered using the WebKit rendering engine. And as I scroll around, I'm seeing the page more or less the way it would show up in the browser. Now, more importantly, any of the interactive elements that you have on the page, like rollovers, or if you have some Ajax-powered widgets, things like that, you'll actually be able to see those working. So notice that when I hover over my rollovers, they're working. And that's true, really, of any of the links that I've got in my site. So I can kind of see how all my rollovers are working. I can test the functionality of a lot of the stuff that I have going on in my page. And I can be sure that the layout is going to be reasonably close to what I should experience in most modern standards compliant browsers. That's awesome, but there are other things that Live View allows me to do. What if I wanted to take a quick tour of my overall site and make sure that everything is looking all right? Maybe you made one change to a specific region and you were wondering, how did that affect all the other regions within my site? Well, if you hold down your control key, and this would be the command key on the Mac, you can click on any one of your links to actually browse to that page right within Dreamweaver. So it's almost like you're in, well, actually you are within a browser within Dreamweaver. Now, at this point, this address bar right here starts to come into play. Notice that it is showing you your current location. And if you continue to go around and navigate through your site, and you can see I'm just clicking on some pages here, maybe learning more about specific tours, maybe wanting to go in and get some specific information about some hiking trails, or just seeing how this layout reacted to any changes that I might have made. The navigation bar right up here is taking all that into account. So now I can start hitting my back button to go through my pages, my forward button to keep going through my pages. And if you get to one of these pages and you're like, you know, I really forgot to do something on this page, or I would like to go ahead and make an edit on this page, you do have some options when you're browsing. Because right now, if I tried to edit any of my code or anything, it wouldn't work because I still have my index page open. But if I go right up here to this menu option, Live View Options, notice that I have the option to edit the Live View page in a new tab. Whatever page I'm on will currently open up. Now I'm free to go ahead and make any edits on this page that I need. All right, well, I'm going to close this out, and I need to get back to our index page. So the quickest way to do that is just to click right here, just like you're in a browser, and click the home button. So there we go. Okay, so with Live View still on, I do need to make one small tweak. As I scroll down here, I notice that the Tour Spotlight, Tour Details, and this Explorer's Podcast headline, I'd like those to be a little bit tighter. There's maybe a little bit too much space between that link and that headline. So one of the first things I'd like to do is to know which of the elements on the page I need to tweak in order to make that happen. Do I need to change the margin on the headline to move it up? Do I need to change the bottom margin on this paragraph to move the headline up? Which one of those do I need to do? Well, we have a new feature in CS5 that is really, really helpful when you're trying to determine which element to modify to make a specific change. And it is this one. It is Inspect Mode, or as it's referred to, CSS Inspect. When I turn this on, as I begin to mouse around my layout, I see all of the box model properties for a specific element. Notice that if I hover over monthly specials, for example, I see sort of an aqua teal color, a magenta color, and a yellow. Let me explain those in a little bit more detail. The teal color represents the width and the height of the element. Anything that is sort of that magenta color represents the padding, and the yellow represents the margin for that. So as you're mousing around, not only can you see who's creating the spacing between elements, but you can tell whether it's margins, paddings, content regions, borders. It really gives you a nice overview of that. Now, as you're mousing around, you may have difficulty finding the exact element that you're looking for. So one of the tricks that you can use here is if you've moused over an element, you can use your left arrow to start going up the document tree to your parent elements and the right arrow to continue to introspect in. So you can go back and forth if you're having trouble mousing over a specific region. Now, again, we're interested over here in the spotlight region. So if I mouse over this paragraph, I can see that there is a bottom margin, but it's not touching that headline. So that's probably not it. And if I go down to the headline, well, it doesn't have a top margin. Huh. So what's causing that little extra bit of space there? Well, it's not the tour details link because that doesn't have a margin either. Well, wait a minute. This image right over here, look at that. If I mouse over this image, I notice that it has a fair amount of bottom padding on it. As a matter of fact, that bottom padding is lining up precisely with the edge of that headline. So what I need to do is reduce the padding in this image if I want to move that up. What I'm going to do is hold down my Alt key, that'd be the Command Option key on the Mac, and click my image to bring up the Code Navigator. I'm going to go right down to this Main Content Image, Article Image, click on that. It's going to open the CSS for that up in Code View. And if you don't see the rule right off the bat, you may have to scroll just a little bit to get it. There it is right there. I'm going to take that top padding, the top padding amount, and reduce that down to 0.5 inches. Now what I do is save all, go back in Design View, and turn on Inspect. Now notice that the bottom margin of my paragraph and that element are butting right up against each other, and that image is no longer interfering with that. So CSS Inspect really helped us narrow down exactly which element was causing the problem and made it extremely easy to fix. So Live View and CSS Inspect gives you powerful tools to preview and refine your design during the development process. Although there is no substitute for testing within multiple browsers, if used properly, these features will speed up your development time and help you ensure that you're writing clean, efficient code. Adobe Browser Lab is one of the many services offered by Adobe that have been integrated with Dreamweaver CS5. Although it has been available through Adobe Labs for some time, you may not be familiar with Browser Lab or what it can do for you. If you've used Browser Lab before, you're going to be really pleased with the level of integration between Dreamweaver CS5 and Browser Lab. So, what is Browser Lab? Browser Lab is an online service by Adobe that allows you to preview any page you want in multiple browsers. It's a fantastic tool for making sure that your website is cross-browser compatible. Now, obviously, you want to preview your pages in as many browsers as possible, but very few of us have a setup that allows us to preview our pages in multiple browsers across multiple platforms. That is exactly what Browser Lab allows us to do. Let's take a closer look at Browser Lab and how Adobe has integrated it with Dreamweaver CS5. So here I have my tourdetail.htm page open, but you can really open any page you want to test Browser Lab. Adobe gives us a few different ways to access Browser Lab, and I want to show you a couple of those. Now, first off, we can go up to the menu, and you can go to Window, Extensions, Adobe Browser Lab. That will open up the Adobe Browser Lab panel. There are a few other ways to access this that you might find a little quicker. Now, I'm going to go ahead and close the panel and show you a couple of those. Now, first off, if you notice in the application toolbar here in the upper right-hand corner, now if you're on a Mac, the application toolbar will be docked close down here to the document toolbar, but you're looking for this CS Live panel. Now, if I click on that, one of the integrated services offered in the CS Live panel is Preview in Adobe Browser Lab. That, again, would open up the same panel that we just looked at. And yet another way to preview in Adobe Browser Lab, and probably the easiest, is over here in the document toolbar itself, where you're probably used to going ahead and previewing your pages in browsers using this icon. You click on that, and you have a whole list of all the browsers that you have loaded. But now, in addition to those browsers, we also have Preview in Adobe Browser Lab. Well, let's check it out and see what that does for us. I'm going to click on Preview Adobe Browser Lab, and that's going to take us to the Adobe Browser Lab site. Now, the first time you access this, you're going to be prompted to log in with your Adobe ID and your password. If you don't already have an Adobe ID, you'll be prompted to go ahead and get one. They're free, and it only takes a minute to sign up. So you're going to need to go ahead and do that to access Adobe Browser Lab. Once you sign in, Dreamweaver is going to upload your page to Adobe's Browser Lab's staging server, which is then going to take screenshots in the browsers that you request. So which browsers did you request? Well, if you're using Browser Lab for the first time, you're using the default browser set, but you're free to go ahead and build your own to test in exactly the platforms you want to test in. If you look over here in the upper left-hand corner, I can see currently that I'm previewing how this page would look in Firefox 3.0 for Windows. If I grab the pull-down menu, I can see the other browsers that I tested in. Internet Explorer 7.0 for Windows, Firefox 3 for Mac OS X, and Safari 3 for Mac OS X. So since I'm on a PC, maybe I really want to see how this looks on Safari for the Mac. So I can go ahead and click on that, and now I can preview my page as to how this page would look like on Safari. And I get a nice screen cap of that to make sure everything is where it's supposed to be. But let's say I want to be a little bit more proactive or controlling of exactly which environments this is tested in. If I go right up to the top of the Adobe Browser Lab page, I can see there's a little navigation link here for browser sets. I'm going to go ahead and click on that. Right now, all we're looking at is the default browser set, but you can see there's a list of available browsers. Now, as this service matures, you're going to see more and more browsers show up there. But let's say I wanted to test it in the most modern standards compliant browsers. So I want to build a new browser set to enable me to do that. So I'm going to say add new browser set, and I'm just going to call this modern standard. And then I just check the browsers that I want to add to this. So maybe Chrome 3.0, maybe Firefox 3.0, maybe Firefox 3.0 for Windows as well, maybe Internet Explorer 8 and Safari 3 and Safari 4. So you can add as many as you want. You can take some out. You could build an Internet Explorer only browser set. It's totally up to you what you want to do with those. You can rename these browser sets and edit them at any time. Okay, so now how do I preview with my new browser set? Well, I can go right back to my test page. And because I have that connection between Dreamweaver and Browser Lab at the moment, I can go ahead and refresh that connection. So I can go right over here to this refresh button and click refresh the screenshots. What it's going to do now is it's going to upload all those assets again and take screenshots based on my current browser set. And after the page is done refreshing, I now have new screenshots available for me. I can go see what it looks like in Chrome 3.0 for Windows, Internet Explorer 8.0. I've got my whole list. Now, there are a couple of other things that we can do here within this environment to help us. Number one, you'll notice that we have a little dialog box over here in the right-hand corner called Delay. If you have some items such as Ajax widgets or complicated CSS that might require a second or two for the page to load before you wanted to take the snapshot, you go ahead and put in the amount of delay that you want. So if you put in 2 seconds of delay, Browser Lab will wait for 2 seconds and then take the screenshots to allow any of those elements to load. We also have some zooming features. We can go all the way up to 400%, all the way down to 75%. So you can zoom in and zoom out to check out and examine close areas of your page. One of my favorite features is the ability to have rulers and rule guides so that you can see from one browser to another how an element is lining up with other elements or staying in place. So if I go over here to my view menu, which is in the upper left-hand corner, I can choose show rulers. At that point, maybe I want to make sure that this logo isn't going to be wandering from one browser to another. So notice I can put the ruler guide right there at the very bottom of that by just simply dragging it out from the rulers. So now I could go through my browser menu and see exactly how that logo lines up in each one of those, and I'm feeling pretty good about that. Now, you could also change your view to a two-up model where you would have one browser on one side and another browser on the other side. So maybe I could check Firefox in Windows versus Safari for the Mac and see how those two would compare. And we can also do what's known as onion skin. Now, what onion skin is going to do is overlay those two browsers on top of each other. So while the ruler guide looked okay, we can see that there are some slight differences in placement between Safari 4.0 for the Mac and Firefox 3.0 for Windows. We could also go down and say, all right, well, what about Firefox 3.0 for the Mac? And we could see that while there are some slight differences there, they're a little bit closer. So you could use that to monitor exactly how pixel precise you are from one browser to another, and maybe give yourself an idea of which elements need to be moved around or what is acceptable or what's not acceptable. Notice also you can shade it from one side to the other. So if you want to see more of Firefox for the Mac versus Firefox for Windows, you can go from one side to the other. So you can get ideas in terms of who is shifting which way or which elements aren't displaying properly based on the available browsers. There's also hotkeys available too. So if you want to change your views, you simply click on the hotkeys button here to view those. And they're pretty easy to memorize. The two-up view is 2, for example. So if I hit 2, after I close my hotkeys, if I hit the number 2, it's going to switch me to a two-up view. 1's going to give me a single view. So my up and my down arrows will move me through the browser set. Now, one last thing that I want to talk about in terms of integration. If I switch back to Dreamweaver, any time that you are previewing this inside Browser Lab locally, there's a couple of things that you need to be aware of. First off, if you make a change to the page at all, if I just, say, took a letter away and put it back in there and then saved it, notice that instead of a green light, we're getting a yellow light. That's Browser Lab telling you, wait a minute, you've made a change since the last time you've previewed. So if you want to view the page accurately now, you need to go ahead and preview it again. There's also one other thing that you really need to be aware of. Dreamweaver CS5 continues to have WebKit integration built into it. So if we were to click on the Live View Preview button, the Design View window pane now shows us our page previewed using the WebKit rendering engine. Well, if you have Live View on, when you preview it in Browser Lab, Browser Lab is going to take a snapshot of the WebKit rendering, so it might not be as accurate as you would want it to be based on your HTML being previewed in, say, Internet Explorer 6 or Safari 3. You're really looking at it in terms of the WebKit rendering within Dreamweaver. So before you preview, make sure Live View is turned off. Now, Browser Lab isn't going to tell you exactly what's wrong with your CSS, but it's worth noting that it provides you with a powerful tool for previewing your page in industry-standard browsers, even across platforms. As a designer, this type of information is extremely valuable. It can save you considerable time during the development process and help you avoid costly errors. As you start working with Dreamweaver CS5, take some time to explore Adobe's Integrated Browser Lab service. I think you'll quickly find it an invaluable part of your design workflow.